नमस्कार साथियों, स्वागत है आप सभी का हमारे एक और एपिसोड इस चैनल सी सून पर। और जैसा कि आपको पता है, हमारे संक्रमण के दौर पर एक छोटी सी मुहिम है कि आप तक देश दुनिया के जगत से ऐसे लोगों को लेके आएँ जो कि बहुत प्रभावी व्यक्तित्व हैं, जो कि बहुत अमेजिंग पर्सनैलिटीज़ हैं अपने आप में और जिन्होंने दुनिया में अपनी अमिट छाप छोड़ी है। अपने सक्सेस स्टोरीज उनकी इतनी ज़्यादा हैं कि उनको लाना हमारे लिए कोई मतलब इज़ अ वेरी मच नॉट एन ऑप्शन। हम उनको लाते हैं, आप तो उनकी बढ़िया बढ़िया बातें रखते हैं, उनकी सक्सेस स्टोरीज, उनके चैलेंजेस, ताकि आप और हम उनकी जीवन यात्रा से बहुत कुछ सीख सकें, उनकी जो पॉजिटिव चीज़ें हैं उनसे हम सीख सकें कि उन्होंने अपनी लाइफ में क्या क्या चैलेंजेस देखे और कैसे उन्होंने लोगों को गाइड किया है, मेंटर किया है। और आज इसी श्रृंखला में हमारे साथ एक बहुत ही खास मेहमान जुड़ी हुई हैं, डॉक्टर शशिकला गुरपुर जी, जो कि डायरेक्टर हैं सिम्बायोसिस लॉ स्कूल पुणे में। वो डीन भी हैं फैकल्टी ऑफ लॉ सिम्बायोसिस इंटरनेशनल डीम्ड यूनिवर्सिटी की, और साथ ही शी इज़ अ ग्रेट मेंटर, एन एकेडमिशियन, एन एजुकेशनलिस्ट एंड अ रिफॉर्मिस्ट अमंग सो मेनी अदर हैट्स दैट शी डॉन्स। अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू यू मैम, एंड थैंक यू सो मच फॉर स्पेयरिंग टाइम टू कम ऑन अवर शो। सी यू सून।
नमस्कार जयंत, धन्यवाद फॉर इन्वॉल्विंग मी।
मैम, बिफोर वी स्टार्ट अवर फॉर्मल क्वेश्चन आंसर, हम लोग की एक परंपरा रहती है कि हम हमेशा एक बेसिक सवाल अपने अतिथियों से करते हैं और ये पूछते हैं कि बिफोर यू वेंट टू द फॉर्मल स्कूल ऑफ ग्रेजुएशन, पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन ग्रेजुएशन एंड देन डूइंग योर PhD, प्लीज़ शेड सम लाइट फॉर आवर व्यूअर्स, जहाँ पे वी गेट टू नो अबाउट योर इनिशियल लाइफ जर्नी, योर अर्ली एजुकेशन एंड वॉट इंस्पायर्ड यू टू टेक लॉ एज अ करियर।
आपको हमारी ये जो जीवन यात्रा है इसके बारे में बताइए तो। पापा के गांव से 2 घंटा ड्राइव थी, उधर से हमारे संस्कृति है हमारे कम्युनिटी में कि लड़की के घर को रहता है, तो उधर से हमें लेके ये गांव में आ गए। और इस गांव में एक ही स्कूल था, वो स्कूल चलाते थे एक हेडमास्टर जी, अपने फैमिली मेंबर्स को मास्टर जी बना के। तो उस स्कूल में 7वीं कक्षा तक हमारी पढ़ाई हो गई कन्नड़ा मीडियम में, और उस स्कूल में ठीक तरह की व्यवस्था नहीं थी, लेकिन हम बहुत खुश थे क्योंकि हमें आजू बाजू में जो खेतियाँ थी उनमें लेके जाके हमें साइंस सिखाते थे, या खुला आसमान के नीचे हमें बिठा के कहानियाँ सुनाते थे, बंदर की कहानी अभी भी याद है मेरे को वो स्कूल का। तो उधर कन्नड़ा मीडियम में पढ़ते टाइम भी हमें एक अजीब एक एक्सपीरियंस होता था, क्योंकि वो स्कूल में एक स्टोर रूम था, हमें स्कूल के स्कूल डे के दिन उस स्टोर रूम के अंदर प्रैक्टिस करने के लिए लेके जाते थे। उधर बहुत सारी सामग्री थी, लेजिम थी और वो दांडिया खेलने की दांडिया थी, तो इसलिए बहुत क्यूरियोसिटी होता था। और बड़े बड़े कंपोस्ट बॉक्सेस थे, तो ऐसे वो कंपास बॉक्स को एक बार साल में हमारे टीचर क्लास में लेके आके बोर्ड में लेके हमें ज्योमेट्री सिखाते थे। ऐसी थी हमारी पढ़ाई, पूरा ओरल साइड से होती थी, लैब में इन्वॉल्व होके पढ़ने की मौका हमें उन स्कूल्स में नहीं मिला था। फिर भी हम खुश थे क्योंकि गाँव में क्या होता है, आपका लर्निंग ऑल कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव होता है, आप प्रकृति से पढ़ते, फ्रेंड से पढ़ते, उनके साथ भाग के खेत में भागने में पढ़ते, पेड़ क्लाइम करने में पढ़ते, तो सिखाने सीखने का जो दम है विलेजेस में वो मिट्टी के साथ मिलके होता है। तो वो स्कूल में अच्छा अनुशासन था, टीचर्स टाइम टेबल पर क्लास चलाते थे और हमें एक्टिविटीज़ भी था। इतना अंडर प्रिविलेज स्कूल था, लेकिन वो गांधीयन सिस्टम ऑफ फंडामेंटल एजुकेशन जो बुनियादी शिक्षण बोलते थे उसके बेसिस पर स्ट्रक्चर हुआ था। फिर पब्लिक एग्ज़ाम के लिए हमें स्कूल में मौका नहीं था क्योंकि कम बच्चे होते हैं, तो पब्लिक एग्ज़ाम उधर नहीं चलेगा। हमें 7th स्टैंडर्ड में पब्लिक एग्ज़ाम था, हमें दूसरे एक स्कूल में लेके गए, तो उधर पब्लिक एग्ज़ाम बैठना था। फिर उसी स्कूल में बाद में हमें 8th स्टैंडर्ड को जाना पड़ा, हम पब्लिक एग्ज़ाम में डिस्ट्रिक्ट में 7वीं ऐसी रैंक आ गए, तो इसलिए स्कूल में बहुत बड़ा सेलिब्रेशन हो गया। मुझे अभी भी याद है, मेरे फादर उसके बारे में ज़्यादा बताए ही नहीं क्योंकि वो बोलते थे शुरू से हमें मालूम है तुम अच्छे हो पढ़ाई में, तो ऐसा हमें ज़्यादा ईगो ऑफ नहीं करना, ये फिलॉसफी घर में चलता था, सिंप्लिसिटी। तो हम हाई स्कूल में चले गए। हाई स्कूल का कहानी बहुत अजीब है क्योंकि हाई स्कूल में हमें मैथ्स और साइंस टीचर्स ही नहीं थे, वो सरकारी हाई स्कूल था। इस अनुशासन की स्कूल से वो बे अनुशासन स्कूल में जाना जहाँ सब कुछ अपने अपनी तकदीर पर छोड़ते थे। मेरे क्लास में मेरे को एक दो चीज़ें बहुत क्यूरियस है, मेरे क्लास में कुछ बच्चे थे उनका नाम पुकारने पर टीचर बोलते थे नारायण SC, ये SC क्या होता है बोल के मैं सोचती थी, तो उनकी जात की नाम क्यों आगे लगाना, इसलिए हम अपने सर्टिफिकेट से अपना शेट्टी नाम हटा दिया था। तो उन्होंने गांव का नाम लगा दिया गुरपुर बोल के। तो ऐसे हमारे नाम के साथ गांव का नाम जुड़ा हो गया। और इधर महाराष्ट्र में आने के बाद 2007 में उनको सभी को कोल्हापुरे सोल्लापुरे बोल के गुरपुरे बहुत ज़्यादा खास लगा, ये शशिकला शेट्टी बोल के बोलने से। तो
जी
ऐसा हमारे नाम के साथ गुरपुर जुड़ा है और हम इतना खुश हैं इसके लिए, क्योंकि कहीं भी गए हमारे गांव की नाम हमारे साथ जुड़ी है, जो अपनी बचपना है बचपन है।
जी
और उसके बाद हाई स्कूल में क्या हुआ, हाई स्कूल में हमारे एक हिंदी टीचर बोले, देखो तुम खाली कन्नड़ में सीखोगे और सब कुछ तुम कन्नड़ में सीखते हो, मैथ्स कन्नड़ में सीखते हो, साइंस कन्नड़ में सीखते हो, लेकिन ये एक हिंदी लैंग्वेज बोल के एक लैंग्वेज है, 10th के एग्ज़ाम में हिंदी लैंग्वेज में हमें थर्ड लैंग्वेज था, वो थर्ड
जी
लैंग्वेज में तुम 43 out of 50 से ज़्यादा मिला तो तुम्हें स्कॉलरशिप मिलेगा। तो मेरे पापा भी बोलते थे हिंदी ज़्यादा सीखना, क्योंकि हिंदी लिंक्स द होल कंट्री, उनको
जी
बहुत अभिमान था, सारी इंडिया इतना बड़ा है। उस जमाने के लोगों को बड़ी विजन थी लेकिन छोटी अपॉर्चुनिटी थी, क्योंकि ट्रांसपोर्ट एटसेट्रा इंडिया में एयर ट्रांसपोर्ट वाज बहुत, इट वाज वेरी लेस यू नो। तो
मैम ये हम किस,
हमारी
अगर आप स्पेसिफाई कर सकें, हम किस डेकेड की बात कर रहे हैं ये?
इट इज आई वाज इन द स्कूल बिटवीन 1971 टू 1980। तो
जी
उस टाइम में मैं स्कूल में सुबह जाती थी और हमारे साथ एक नौकर जाता था, क्योंकि हमारे बैग पकड़ने को, हमें खाना खिलाने को दोपहर में फ्रेश खाना लेके वो आता था, इसलिए एक नौकर रखे थे। हम चार बच्चे थे, बाद में इन बच्चों का लीडरशिप मुझे ही लेना पड़ा, उनको इधर उधर, मैं आई वॉज द फर्स्ट चाइल्ड इन द हाउस।
जी
सो आई टोल्ड यू स्कूलिंग वॉज नॉट जस्ट स्टडीइंग इंफॉर्मेशन, इट वॉज मोर ऑफ लाइफ स्किल। और कुछ कुछ लाइक जहाँ हम रहते थे नदी के बाजू, आज भी वो प्रॉपर्टी है हमारा जहाँ पूजा घर है, वो नदी में बाढ़ आने पर हमें स्कूल नहीं जाना, बोट घर में रखते थे, वो बोटिंग करके हमारे पापा ही स्कूल में लेके जाते थे 3-4 दिन अगर स्कूल छूट गया तो। तो एजुकेशन का इम्पोर्टेंस हमारे फैमिली में और हमारे गांव में जो सीखा गया वो पूरे हाई स्कूल में बर्बाद हो गई, क्योंकि हाई स्कूल में क्या हुआ, ये सरकारी स्कूल होने के नाते टीचर्स ट्रांसफर हो गए तो रिप्लेसमेंट नहीं आता था,
जी
क्योंकि टीचर्स पूरा कर्नाटक के बाकी रीजन के थे, इधर आके उनको एडजस्ट होना, खाना पीना अलग अलग रहता है हर एक रीजन में, और उनके फैमिली उधर रहता था, इस सैलरी में फैमिली को इधर ला के रहने की मौका नहीं था। तो इसलिए हम सारे बच्चे 8th और 9th में बिना फाउंडेशन ऑफ मैथ, हमारा मैथ का फाउंडेशन 7th स्टैंडर्ड का था, साइंस का फाउंडेशन भी वैसा था, सेल्फ स्टडी करने की ज़रूरत थी, फिर भी हमें घर में इतना अनुशासन था। और नो ट्यूशन, ट्यूशन वी वेर अगेंस्ट ट्यूशन, किसी के ट्यूशन क्लास में जाना हमें इंसल्ट था स्कूल में जाके, देखिए आज की वैल्यूज़ देखिए तब का वैल्यूज़ देखिए। तो हम सेल्फ स्टडी करके चार चार बार पढ़ के हम हाई स्कूल में बाकी बच्चों को हम सिखाते थे ग्रुप बना के। तो हमारे स्कूल में कितने 4 लोग पास हो गए, और आई वॉज द आई एंड अनदर बॉय वेयर फर्स्ट क्लास, और हमें वंस अगेन आई गॉट द रैंक, इसलिए हमें एडमिशन मिला। लेकिन वो भी एक बड़ी कहानी है, क्योंकि वो उधर स्कॉलरशिप हिंदी का तो हमें 94% इक्विवेलेंट मिला और सब्जेक्ट्स में 80+ मिला, इसलिए कॉलेज में टॉप मोस्ट कॉलेज था सेंट एग्नेस कॉलेज मैंगलोर में, 16 किलोमीटर जाना था वो कॉलेज के लिए, और वो कॉलेज में जाना इतना आसान नहीं था, क्योंकि हम उधर रिजल्ट आने के बाद एडमिशन को गए, उधर टेंटेटिव एडमिशंस ख़त्म हो गए थे। तो जब मेरे पापा जाके उधर के हेड सिस्टर सिस्टर एलोशिया को सुनाए तो वो बोले ठीक है, तो गांव में पढ़ी हुई लड़की तो हम एंकरेज करना चाहिए, बल्कि कल सुबह आ जाओ मैं एक एप्लीकेशन आउट ऑफ द वे दे दूंगी। फिर हम उस कॉलेज में भर्ती हो गए, उधर से हमारी पर्सनैलिटी ही चेंज हो गया, क्योंकि मिशनरी कॉलेज था जहाँ गरीबों के लिए काम करते थे, वो कॉलेज के एक्सटेंडेड स्कूल को नेशनल लेवल में डिजेबल्ड के साथ काम करने के लिए बड़ा अवार्ड मिला, और कॉलेज में हम और हमारे स्वीपर के बच्चे साथ में पढ़ते थे, ऐसा एक क्लासलेस एंड कंपैशनेट एंड प्रेयरफुल एनवायरनमेंट एंड ऑल विमेन।
जी
तो वो मेरे को कन्विंस किया कि औरत कुछ भी कर सकती है, औरत बन के तुम घर में ही रहने की ज़रूरत नहीं है, गांव में जैसे औरतें घर से जाते काम करके घर को वापस आके फिर घर का काम करते, वैसा नहीं, संस्था के साथ औरतें जुड़ी जुड़े हो सकते, ये सब मैसेजेस उधर से मिला। लेकिन मेरे 10th के एग्ज़ाम के लिए हमें सिटी को आना पड़ा, क्योंकि उस विलेज में एग्ज़ाम सेंटर नहीं था, गवर्नमेंट वाज नॉट रिकग्नाइजिंग। तो उसके लिए हमारे पापा फिर से 2 लोगों को अरेंज किए हमें बस में लेके जाने का, लेकिन क्योंकि 20 किलोमीटर्स, तो इतना इतना बैकवर्ड या अंडर डेवलप्ड इंडिया से हम आज कैसे इतना डेवलप्ड इंडिया को जा रहे हैं, फिर भी मेरे को लगता है मेरी जैसी लड़कियां बहुत सारे गांव में होंगी आज भी। इसलिए हम जहां भी हमें मौका मिला तब हम गांव में जाके लोगों से बात करते थे। तो मेरा जर्नी ऐसा हुआ, सेंट एग्नेस में आई वॉज वन ऑफ द टॉप साइंस स्टूडेंट्स, कॉलेज में 12th में भी अच्छा मार्क्स मिला, 3 बार मेडिकल एडमिशन का ये आ गया, इंजीनियरिंग का हमें इंटरेस्ट नहीं था, आयुर्वेदिक का आ गया। हम वो छोड़ के BSc करेंगे बोल के जुड़ के बैठे, क्योंकि हमें वो एक मालूम था मेरे को मेडिकल एजुकेशन इज़ एक्सपेंसिव एंड आई डिडंट वांट टू ट्रबल माय फादर बिकॉज वी हैड अदर 3 siblings। सेकेंडली मेरे को मेडिकल एजुकेशन होने के बाद फिर क्या, बड़ा हॉस्पिटल खोलो उसमें काम करो, उसके लिए फिर इन्वेस्टमेंट इंटेंसिव बोल के हमने, और चाइल्डहुड से आई वॉज अ वेरी गुड डिबेटर, वेरी गुड पब्लिक स्पीकर। सो मेरे को लगा इससे ही मेरी रास्ता जुड़ा है, लेकिन क्या बोल के मालूम नहीं। मे बी आई विल टीच, मे बी आई विल बिकम ए स्कॉलर, ऐसे सोच के हमने 12th स्टैंडर्ड से डिविएशन नहीं लिया। बट BSc में पढ़ना भी आसान नहीं था, क्योंकि क्लास में 70 बच्चे थे। इन 70 का चेहरा देखते ही हमारी बॉटनी टीचर बोलते थे, लुक एट यू ऑल, यू लुक सो डल, यू हैव नो एम्बिशन। ऐसे सोच मेरे को इंसल्ट लगता था वैसे बोलने पर। एक बार मैं सीधे टीचर के पास जाके बोली कि ऐसे आप नहीं बोलना, क्योंकि हम सब अच्छे मार्क्स वाले हैं, हमने ये चॉइस किया है। तो सिस्टर को अजीब लगा। उस दिन के बाद वो हमारे साथ बहुत रेस्पेक्ट से बात करने लगे, और हम डिबेट में जाते थे। सारी साल डिबेट में जाने से हमारा कुछ पेंडिंग रहता था, लैब वर्क ये सब, बट एक ही बार बैठ के हम करते थे। तो एक बार सिस्टर बोले, तुम डिबेट ही करो, ये क्यों करते हो, एक टीचर बोले। बट दूसरे टीचर उनको डिफेंड किए कि उनका हर्बेरियम देखो, बाकी बच्चे पिकनिक के हर्बेरियम लेके आए, ये अपने घर के आजू बाजू के हर्बेरियम पकड़ा है, इसका मतलब उनको नेचर के साथ साइंस को जुड़ने का टैलेंट है
जी।
तो उधर क्या हुआ, हम चाइल्डहुड से देखे थे इनजस्टिस, क्लास कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स में जैसे बोली, स्कूल में भी देखी। आई ऑलवेज फेल्ट माय लैंडलॉर्ड बैकग्राउंड, थोड़ा प्रिविलेज्ड बैकग्राउंड, वो मेरे लिए बहुत खर्च लगता था, क्योंकि उसकी वजह से हमें मिक्स होने का ये नहीं मिलता था। अगर बाकी लोगों से हम मिले तो घर में प्रश्न पूछा जाता था, क्योंकि लड़कियां, बड़े घर के लड़कियां किसी से डिस्टेंस रख के बड़े होना होता है, अपने संस्कार और फैमिली का सम्मान रखना पड़ता है। तो जाति का एक जो आवरण था वो बार बार एम्फसाइज होता था, लेकिन बाकी चीज़ों में हमें सपोर्ट था घर में। माई फादर वॉज़ ए वेरी लिबरल मैन, ही वर्क इन ब्रिटिश कंपनी। फिर गाँव में आके रहने का चॉइस किया उन्होंने ऋषिकेश के, वो ऋषिकेश में 8 साल एक स्वामी के साथ रह के फिर आके शादी करने का डिसीजन लिया, और ऐसे हमें उस डिसिप्लिन में बढ़ा के, एक तरफ से ग्लोबलिज्म, एक तरफ से एब्सोल्यूट स्पिरिचुअलिज्म। एंड ही वॉज रनिंग ए काइंड ऑफ लीगल एड इन द विलेज, उनके पास सारे गांव के डिस्प्यूट्स आते थे, बिकॉज ही वॉज कंसिडर्ड एज द वाइज मैन, पावरफुल मैन, इसलिए चर्च मॉस्क सभी अपने गुरु से इक्वल हमारे पापा को मानते थे। हमारे घर में उनकी प्रॉपर्टीज रहते थे सेफ्टी रखने के लिए। ही वॉज मोर ट्रस्टेड इन द विलेज, वो ट्रस्टवर्दीनेस जो है। दूसरी, कॉन्फ्लिक्ट के टाइम वीक का साइड लेना, वो पूरा अपने पास जो भी डिस्प्यूट्स आए तब औरत का साइड लेते थे वो, और बोलते थे औरत बोलती नहीं, और औरत को अपना पोजीशन मालूम भी नहीं रहता है बोल के वो नेगोशिएट करके आदमी लोगों को बेंड करके औरत को प्रॉपर्टी का डिवीजन देते थे। तो ये मैंने देखे देखी थी छोटे उम्र में, और वो देखे बड़ी हो गई तो मेरे को लगता था ये जस्टिस अपने ऊपर लेना भी कितना ठीक है, वो भी मैं सोचती थी। वन डे आई टोल्ड हिम ऑल्सो कि आपका पनिशमेंट ठीक है बोल के, आपको मालूम कैसा, आई डिड नॉट नो वन डे आई विल रीड ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस, यू नो। तो ये सब हम हाई स्कूल में करते थे, लेकिन सेंट एग्नेस में फाइनल ईयर में जब हम थे, हमारे पापा को सडनली हार्ट अटैक आ गया। शायद उन्होंने छुपा के रखा था बाद में, बिकॉज आई वॉज इन द फाइनल ईयर ऑफ BSc, मेरे को वो क्रुशियल ईयर था, मेरे को बुलाया गया हॉस्पिटल में कि ही इज़ सीरियस, क्योंकि हमारे घर में बाहर जाके कोई जाने वाले नहीं, मेरी माँ शी वॉज अ वेरी होमली वूमन, तो ज़्यादा बाहर जाने का स्किल्स भी नहीं था उनको, और ब्रदर एंड सिस्टर वेर वेरी यंग। तो मैं गई तो वो डॉक्टर मुझे बोले अगर इनको स्ट्रेस कुछ भी नहीं देते तो ये 25 साल जिएंगे, अगर इनका अभी का जो भी स्ट्रेस है वो, ये स्ट्रेस बोल की चीज़ क्या होता है बोल के मेरे को समझ में नहीं आया। और उन्होंने पूछा तुम्हारी फैमिली में प्रॉपर्टी है क्या, हम बोले हाँ। केसेस है क्या, मैं बोली हाँ केसेस है, तो वो केसेस का जिम्मेदारी कोई लेना पड़ेगा, और वो प्रॉपर्टी को ठीक से शांति से ये करना निपटाना पड़ेगा। तो क्या करोगे तुम, तुम्हारी एल्डर ब्रदर, आई सेड देयर इज नो एल्डर ब्रदर। तो मैं घर वापस आई, पूरा रिकॉर्ड निकाली, मेरे को कुछ भी समझ में नहीं आया। आई न्यू ओनली माई लैब एंड माई रिकॉर्ड्स एंड माई डिबेट्स बुक्स एंड टॉकिंग। तो उधर से हमारी जर्नी शुरू हुआ कि प्रॉब्लम सॉल्विंग के लिए कानून चाहिए, कानून की जानकारी चाहिए। इसलिए उस साल योगा योग से हमारी जिंदगी में बहुत सारी चीज़ें योगा योग से हुई है। योगा योग से उस साल का लास्ट डिबेट मेरा फाइनल ईयर का हुआ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनलिज्म के बारे में। ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनलिज्म हमने 10th स्टैंडर्ड में सिटीजनशिप में पढ़े हैं, उसके बाद पढ़े नहीं है। तो मैं पढ़ने लगी और बुक्स पूरा कलेक्ट करने लगी। मेरे को बहुत क्यूरियोसिटी लगा, मेरे को सूटेबल है बोल के लगा। तो मैं सीधा वो डिबेट में दाखिल हुई एंड आई वन द डिबेट। लॉ स्टूडेंट सेकेंड आ गई। तो वो प्रोफेसर उधर जो थे वो मैं डिबेट कंपटीशन के बाद मुझे बाहर बुलाए और पूछे, तुम लॉ कॉलेज को क्यों नहीं ज्वाइन करती, यू आर अ बॉर्न एडवोकेट बोले। तो मैं ये सोच के फिर घर वापस आई। लेकिन मुझे ये लॉयर के बारे में क्या है, हमारे मंगलूर सिटी विच वॉज अ कोस्टल सिटी विच इज़ अ टीयर थर्ड बिग सिटी इन कर्नाटका, इट हैज़ लार्ज मेजोरिटी ऑफ पीपल ऑब्जर्विंग मैट्रिलिनी, बट द माइंड सेट इज वुमन इज इन द हाउस एंड मेन आर इन द पब्लिक स्फीयर। तो उधर के लॉ कॉलेज में या आप कोर्ट में, मैं कोर्ट में कभी नहीं गई थी, ये केस की वजह से जाने लगी। कोर्ट में औरत दिखती नहीं थी, आदमी ही आदमी कहाँ भी देखे तो हमें तो डर नहीं है क्योंकि हम को एजुकेशन में बड़े हो गए थे हाई स्कूल तक। कॉलेज में औरतों के कॉलेज में थे। तो फिर लॉ कॉलेज में जाके मेरा योगा योगा ऐसा था, हमें एक भगवान जैसा एक प्रिंसिपल थे। ही वॉज अ प्रैक्टिसिंग लॉयर हु वॉज मेड द प्रिंसिपल बिकॉज मैनेजमेंट विच वॉज अ टेम्पल मैनेजमेंट हैड लॉट ऑफ ट्रस्ट इन हिम। उनको 5 डॉटर्स थे तो हमें वो अपने डॉटर्स के तरह ट्रीट करके हमें घर में लेके जाते थे। उनको अजीब लगता था, एक लेडी इतना अच्छा बात करती है। सो ही वॉज ऑलवेज परप्लेक्स्ड अबाउट हाउ आई वुड हैव बीन ब्रॉट अप एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट। तो मेरे साथ वो बहुत कॉन्वर्जेशंस लगा कि एक दिन बोले, देखो देर आर वेरी फ्यू वीमेन इन दिस फील्ड एंड यू गो अहेड, यू डू हायर स्टडीज एंड यू आर कट आउट फॉर दैट बोले। क्योंकि कॉलेज में इलेक्शन कैंपेन चलते चलते टाइम हम बहुत स्पीच देने को जाते थे, लड़के प्रेसिडेंट के लिए खड़े होते थे, हम उनके कैंपेन, और मेरे को लक्की माना जाता था एज ए कैंपेनर। सो देर विल बी कॉम्पिटिशन बिटवीन दीज बॉयज़ हु इज़ टू कंटेस्ट। सो 2 साल हमने कैंपेन चलाया। थर्ड ईयर मेरे पापा का पैरालिसिस हो गया, फिर भी मैं सपोर्ट कर रही हूँ बोल के दैट वॉज एन आइटम इन द कैंपेन। सो आई हैड अ वेरी गुड पर्सनैलिटी फॉर लीडरशिप विच आई नेवर एनकैश्ड और डिस्कवर्ड और थॉट बिग अबाउट, बिकॉज वुमन नेवर थिंक्स दैट दिस इज़ अ गिफ्ट, वुमन थिंक्स दिस इज़ अ कर्स। बिकॉज द मोर विजिबल यू आर, यू फील यू आर वल्नरेबल टू अटैक, कैरेक्टर असैसिनेशन या फिजिकल रिमार्क्स, और बिकॉज वुमन्स आइडेंटिटी वॉज ऑलवेज स्ट्रांगली बॉडी, यू नो, नॉट हर एसेंस। सो ये सोच के हम थोड़ा हेजिटेट होते थे, लेकिन जब हमें एंकरेजमेंट मिलता था हम अपना निजी स्वभाव से जाके कैंपेन करना, बात करना, नेगोसिएशन करना, ऐसे करके। हमें उस टाइम बोला था, यू कैन कंटेस्ट इन योर फाइनल ईयर फॉर अ सेक्रेटरी पोजिशन, ऐसे बोले थे। तो ये सेक्रेटरी पोजिशन क्या होता है? सेक्रेटरी पोजिशन इज नो पोजिशन एट ऑल, शी जस्ट सिट्स देयर। मैंने दोनों सीरीज में देखा था, मेरा फर्स्ट LLB और सेकेंड LLB में। लेकिन पूरा सेल्स, कॉलेज में एक्टिविटीज चलाना, लड़कों को साथ में लेके एक्टिविटी स्टेज करना, इन सब में आई वॉज इन द लीडरशिप। सो आई वॉज दी फैक्टो लीडर, दी जूरे दे वॉन्टेड अ बॉय टू बी द प्रेसिडेंट। सो आई डिड नॉट से मच, बट मेरे प्रिंसिपल मेरे को बुला के, बिकॉज दैट टाइम वी हैड अ फॉर्मर मिनिस्टर हु यूज टू बी अ विजिटिंग फैकल्टी, मिस्टर रॉड्रिगेस, ही टुक ए लॉट ऑफ लाइकिंग। बिकॉज वेन आई वॉज डूइंग लॉ इट सेल्फ, आई वॉज रनिंग ए स्मॉल क्लिनिक, इन द सेंस आई टू गो टू द कोर्ट एंड टेक माई विलेज, पुअर विलेज वीमेन एंड मेन फॉर देयर केस फॉलो, बिकॉज दे डिंट अंडरस्टैंड, दे आर स्केर्ड ऑफ द कोर्ट, दे डिंट अंडरस्टैंड वॉट दिज लॉयर्स आर टॉकिंग इन इंग्लिश, या दे डिंट नो दैट विच केस शुड गो वेयर, शुड अ वर्क रिलेटेड केस गो टू लेबर कोर्ट, दे डिंट नो एनी थिंग अबाउट। सो आई यूज टू गाइड देम, आई यूज टू स्पेंड फ्रॉम माई पॉकेट मनी एंड टेक देम टू द DC ऑफिस, AC ऑफिस। हमें ये कानून को यूज़ करके लोगों को ज़िंदगी बदलने का काम बहुत अच्छा लगा। तो हम क्या किए, ये मेरे प्रिंसिपल जो थे वो बताए, लुक Now, don't get attracted by this Professor Rodriguez or these students and others. You are cut out for something big. So think of something big. मेरे एक दूसरे टीचर थे रविंद्र सर बोल के, उन्होंने भी पर्सनली बुला के वही बोले LLM में जाओ. तो LLM जाना भी आसान नहीं था, मैसूर में ही था LLM, वो 7 घंटे का बस जर्नी था. और इधर मैंगलोर में उस टाइम पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट डिग्री अवेलेबल नहीं था, आई एम टॉकिंग ऑफ 1988. तो मैसूर में गए, घर छोड़ के फर्स्ट टाइम जा रहे थे. इट वॉज़ वेरी बैड, माई फादर वॉज पैरालिटिक. सो विद ऑल दोज चैलेंजेस आई वेंट एंड टुक LLM. In my first year, 2 days prior to the exam, my father expired. So after, I mean, in the grieving period, I had to write my final semester of the first year. Because a month prior to that, I had visited him. He had called me with lot of effort from my mother's side. He had insisted I should be there. So that time he had said something. I asked him, should I continue or not? Or should I do your seva and remain here? He said, no, you go. But he made me stay with him for one night, and I think something very unusual I experienced that day. Then I went back, and then he expired. So I still remember my one paper, you know, I think it was jurisprudence paper. It was still written with those, I couldn't control my tears when I was writing it. And the teacher came and he said, usually the rule is once you sit in the exam, you don't get up. These days children go to the toilet, they ask me special permission. But we were so loyal to the rule. Then the professor came and he said, you just take a break, because he knew about it. So he said, you just go take a break, have a glass of water. I refused. But I got gold medal, I topped the university, I got 3 awards for my scores, Government of Karnataka's special cash scholarship. So none of my expenses in education I had to pay, always I had scholarship. So my parents thought I was a zero expense child. So after the LLM, my principal from the undergraduate college, he had told, I told you, you'll be the first woman in the history of this college to teach full time. So I became full time teacher. I cleared the NET exam also. In our times, we had negative marks for NET exam. So I did that. But a lot of my bureaucrat friends to whom I used to take these legal aid cases, they said, please don't ever think you are cut out for this. Please try for judiciary or for civil service. I knew that I had the capacity to crack the exam, but that was not something intuitively I knew. That was not something where there is a dearth, because the core of that is here, where you shape human beings, where you influence them, where you give them different choices. Because I looked at my own life, I was coming to a phase of life because of all those teachers who were playing a key role, the institutions, the influence, my parents as teachers, as informal teachers. So after LLM, I started teaching in that college. In the first year, there was an invitation from National Law School. You know, this right. was coinciding
ma'am,
with...
Ma'am, I'll come to that. I'll pause you here for a minute. आपने इतनी बढ़िया अपने जीवन की जर्नी बताई जहाँ पे आपके फादर साहब को बहुत इन्फ्लुएंस रहा आप पे, और आपने बताया किस तरीके से उन्होंने हिंदी एज अ लैंग्वेज को एम्फसाइज किया, दो आई थिंक कन्नड़ इज़ योर मदर टंग जैसे आपने बताया. आई एम सो ग्रेटफुल कि जब मैं मैम को इन्वाइट भी कर रहा था तो मैंने उनको ऑप्शन दिया कि हम हिंदी और इंग्लिश दोनों में प्रोग्राम करते हैं. उन्होंने खुद बोला कि आई प्रेफर टू यू नो स्पीक इन हिंदी. तो वन आई एम रियली ग्रेटफुल मैम, एंड आई एम यू नो वन बिकॉज कोई भी भाषा, और स्पेशली आपने बताया कि हिंदी आपने क्लास 10th में सीखना शुरू किया, उससे पहले जो आपकी स्कूलिंग हुई विलेज में हुई और विलेज का जो एटमॉस्फेयर रहा, इट्स सो फिनोमिनल एंड सो ग्रेट. उसके बाद आपने साइंस पढ़ी, एंड हाउ योर फादर हैज़ बीन सो इंस्ट्रूमेंटल इन शेपिंग योर लाइफ, इन शेपिंग योर करियर इन अ वे. और आपने एक दो प्रोफेसर्स की अपनी और बात की जो वहाँ पे डायरेक्टर भी थे उस टाइम पे आपके लॉ स्कूल में, हु वाज अ गाइडिंग फोर्स व्हेन यू आर ट्राइंग टू विजिट द डिस्ट्रिक्ट कोर्ट्स in your early days. So I have 2-3 questions because I know we have a very long journey to discuss, but I would like to pause it here and come to your LLB days and your BSc days, jahan pe aapne bataya ki you are a natural student leader, and I've had the privilege to be in your company just before the pandemic, and where I had the privilege to be in Symbiosis Pune and meet you in person, and I can vouch that you definitely are a thought leader, you are a true leader, and you are a leader of the masses and of the students. I can definitely vouch for that. It goes without saying. पर ये जो मेरा सवाल अभी 2-3 है आपके शुरुआती जीवन से, वो ये है कि जब आप LLB अपना कर रही थी, उस वक्त जो माहौल था हमारे देश में, बिकॉज वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ 80s राइट नाउ, और आज when यू आर लीडिंग वन ऑफ द बिगेस्ट लॉ स्कूल्स इन द कंट्री, how important in those days were the whole concept of internship or publications and moot courts, all those things, were they even there in terms of concept in law schools? As you said, because you also had this inkling towards helping degrade, because that is also something your father also used to do, help the villagers and be like a father figure to so many people. And I think that is a quality that he has also instilled in you, and it has trickled down. And so how did that shape your law school phase? And because when we are in law school, when we are young, there are so many things which are going on. आपने जैसे बताया कि एक चीज तो ये थी कि that being a woman, and being a scholarly woman, so as to say, when a person says नहीं आप सेक्रेटरी बनिए, आप डायरेक्टर मत बनिए कॉलेज में, जब ये इलेक्शन कंटेस्ट होते हैं, ऑब्वियसली इरिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ जेंडर एंड मोर सो इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ जेंडर, आई थिंक इट्स अ बिग ब्लो टू वन सेल्फ, बिकॉज व्हेन अ पर्सन नोज कि मेरे में मेरिट है, मेरे में वो काबिलियत है कुछ अच्छा करने का, तो कहीं ना कहीं धसका भी लगता है. दूसरा, योर फादर ऑब्वियसली वॉज एलिंग, आपने बताया उस दौरान एज अ यंग स्टूडेंट, बिकॉज लॉट ऑफ यंग स्टूडेंट्स विल बी ट्यूनिंग फॉर दिस प्रोग्राम लेटर वेन वी अपलोड दिस ऑन यूट्यूब. सम ऑफ देम आर टूडे स्पेशली ड्यूरिंग पैंडमिक आर स्ट्रगलिंग फ्रॉम फाइनेंशियल क्रंचेज, द पेरेंट्स हैव सम आइदर हैव लॉस्ट जॉब्स, सम ऑफ द पीपल हैव लॉस्ट देर पेरेंट्स इन द सेकेंड वेव, सो मेनी थिंग्स हैव हैपन्ड. वॉट विल बी योर मैसेज वन टू ऑल द यंग व्यूअर्स हेयर, यंग लॉयर्स हु हैव जस्ट ग्रेजुएटेड, हु आर अबाउट टू ग्रेजुएट, हु आर स्टडिंग, कि कैसे अपने को ढाढ़स बनाएं अगर आपके परिवार में दिक्कत आ रही है, और दूसरा, इफ यू आर अ यंग लॉ स्टूडेंट, हाउ डू यू शेप योर करियर इन टर्म्स ऑफ आइदर एक्स्ट्रा और को करिकुलर एक्टिविटीज.
See, to your first comment, how was the law school when we were studying? Absolutely no idea of internship. So I was informally, because of our own court case, as a litigant in shadow, I used to go and see how these offices were. But they would be so secretive, I mean secretive about the way in which they were handling the file. There was no structured process. There was no way of client communication. We had to follow up. So even to this day, this is one curse in our profession compared to the medical profession, which is so well organized. And there is so much of accountability to the patient, at least in the ethics, So somewhere I think that is where I wrote my first paper on ethics in terms of law school responsibility. And even in the law commission, when I was a member, we had one case from Allahabad High Court, and we were told by the minister, why don't you talk about law school responsibility in ethics? Now, coming to the idea of the crisis that I faced personally, and how did I tide over the crisis? You know, the funny thing, each one of us is endowed with some strength, whether, first of all, in ourselves as person and in our surrounding also. So discovering that strength, I knew that our family had the strength of this arrested capital in the form of property, in the form of certain jewelry, certain money, and the fair share which was due to us in the joint family, which was not given. We were fighting a court case. So I did a calculation and told my mother, if we continue in the case, it will be this much, but it will be after so many years. If we do it, this is now. And most of all, huge untranslated advantage of relationships. Which one do you think is the best? She said relationships. Right. The moment she said relationships, my job was done. So I went back to the community, my relatives, and we settled the thing. Similarly, there was another property which was mired. So where we had collaboration with the person who was a hereditary owner, we were the owners by possession. So we had again negotiation. So out of court settlement. Now, what I learned in this experience, that in every adversity, there is also a hidden opportunity. You need to uncover that. And uncovering that takes lot of research, lot of experience, patience to listen to your advisors, but not going with them, independent mind, and something called sixth sense, intuition. The intuition comes from only one thing, that you are able to see time not as now and tomorrow, but beyond. You may not see the full picture, but it's basically about problem solving skill, which is most important, and that's the gift our profession has. That's why our profession is, any day, even if I was not a lawyer, I would say superior to any other profession on earth, because we keep our mind and our thought process at a certain level where we have all comprehensive approach, because we are finally looking at social equilibrium, equilibrium of rights, and peace, long lasting solution, resolving the conflict. Now, in that light, your first question on those students who have had this sudden adversity of COVID, आई थिंक माई प्रॉब्लम्स आर नथिंग कम्पेयर टू दीज स्टूडेंट्स बिकॉज आई हैड लॉट ऑफ टाइम टू गेट द प्रिमोनिशन ऑफ दीज डिफिकल्टीज विद माई फादर्स फर्स्ट मेडिकल रिपोर्ट एंड देन हिज पैरालिसिस एंड मी डूइंग माई डिग्री. यू नो वॉट आई डिड, माई कैपेसिटी टू कम्युनिकेट एंड क्रिएट ट्रस्ट, नॉट क्रिएटिंग ट्रस्ट बट टचिंग द कॉर्ड इन टर्म्स ऑफ म्यूचुअल ट्रस्ट, आई वेंट टू लॉट ऑफ फैमिली फ्रेंड्स एंड कलेक्टेड सम कैश and made them help. So that's how all the fee could be paid for my siblings. Some of the temporary installments to the loans could be paid. The local grocer, green grocer who was supplying us, he could be paid. So, and some of the medical bills could be handled. And I created a kind of written informal document for them. And then I said, when I work, I'll pay you back. And as luck would have it, the problem of properties got solved. I told them, give me 5 years, I solved it in 1 year. So I think as law students, don't wait till you are fully packaged as a law graduate. As you are learning the law, develop those capacities in your college life. So I connect it to your next question. All our co-curricular and extracurricular activities are our rehearsal grounds to lead people, to fulfill a common objective, to unify the vision, to handle funds, to solve problems, to negotiate differences, and to carry out the mission, to actualize an idea into action, what we call in spiritual terms, manifestation. So this manifestation dimension in terms of putting people together and accomplishing something, Gandhi did. He moved masses. An industrialist does, J.R.D. Tata did. They fulfilled in terms of certain objective, maybe production, it could be service, it could be. So every great thing that happened in humanity is about setting a goal and storming and norming and forming a team and achieving it. I tell you, today I talk it with so much of confidence. Not many law professors or law teachers would talk this way. Usually management people talk this way. Now I got this from my one job in the middle, which you will see in my CV, where I actualized this. Otherwise, I was doing it as a theory, as a debater, and as a toaster, etc. I had the opportunity of heading an admin, HR and legal division of a multinational company in Middle East. Now, at that time, the CEO was from our place. He spotted me in a public function and he invited me, created this profile, a mixed profile. So I became very popular within a year and we were able to increase the production of the company by solving the problems of the patients. You know, Arab patients could be very cantankerous and short-tempered, but if you are addressing their emotions, they could be extremely good as well and loyal to you. So this, while handling that, I had to learn and apply what I learned. So that was the time I learned about whole behavior, team behavior. We in law lack this skill because our profession is all about me, 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 me. But what we have to spot now as students and as teachers and professionals is our profession always had the collaboration dimension, and it is moving more into collaboration in interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary context. When you are executing something like a huge investment coming to India, I mean, you, Mr. Jayant, you yourself had interviewed this wonderful arbitrator whose interview I saw, who was talking about his wife, who is a financial investment advisor. Now, a lot of money is flowing into India. We need that money to build this country, to see that every village has got access to education, every child has got the privilege of opportunities. So our law school products, or as Bar Council report itself says, other tier law school children who are in the remote corners of India, like me, they would have studied in a sleepy town where job opportunities were not thought of anything beyond 1 kilometer. Or 10 kilometers. So such children need to have the opportunity. So for that, we have to train our students, and our students should train themselves with these opportunities to work with people with differences, to have a global classroom, to have online interaction, to learn from online. I'll give you an example of one of my students who came from a financially backward kind of family, whose father was in a very small government job. But the boy was gifted with this ability to study, and he had a younger brother who was equally good in academics. But this boy was extremely bright. So he got admission to our law school in the entrance test. And his mother was so angry when he got 10th marks, 12th marks. शी स्टॉल्ड हिम यू नो शी गॉट सो एंग्री शी वॉन्टेड टू टेयर ऑफ द सर्टिफिकेट ऑफ हिज 12th बिकॉज ही हैड सम 98% और समथिंग एंड ही वॉज हेलबेंट ऑन डूइंग लॉ लाइक मी डिस्पाइट साइंस. So his mother said that, see, what we need is one salary and supporting the family. What we need is you earning. And you are not doing that. You want to study. And in this expensive college, we can't borrow any money. We don't have credit worthiness. She was discouraging him. But this boy, 1 year, he waited. And next year, again, he made it to Symbiosis. And then I think some bank advanced him some money. Some friends advanced him some money. In 1 year, he had made such social connections. But believe you me, in that 1 year he had done so many online courses. By the time he came to the law school, in the class we were finding this child as extraordinary, and I spotted him in one of the class and I was asking other teachers. They said yes, he is amazing, and all the teachers also, our teachers are very dedicated. They encouraged him so much. We sent him for an internship with Mrs. Kiran Bedi, Dr. Kiran Bedi, and she sends me a reference that this is genius of a person in research. We are so pleased with his output. And this boy, later on, when I launched my first international criminal trial advocacy competition, a student drafted a problem which was taken up by one of our friends who was ex-Oxford, who is based out of New Zealand. He asked me, which jurist has drafted this problem? See, that is why I am giving a very clear message to the students. Your own initiative is the one which is going to determine how successful you will be. This boy, by the time he was in the final year, he was picked up by one of the lead law firms and he's doing extremely well. He didn't have the money to buy a court. And I still remember we all pulled money. Many alumni who were familiar with him became his fans. They all pulled money together to give him a settlement allowance. I still remember they called it settlement, professional settlement allowance. So professional settlement grant we created. So these are the various ways by which, from the background that I come from, we try to support students. But if that student is not like this example I'm giving, then we also don't feel motivated to go out of the way and to take such initiative. So participate like him and read. In our profession, no substitute for study and research. Therefore, cultivate a passion for research. And if you enjoy research, you are made as a professional in law. I think you can take either consultancy kind of higher level of attorney position or as a counselor appearance, or you can do the Mofusil code. But whatever it is, even your strategy needs thorough study from all angles. So open-mindedness is very important. So these qualities grow when you interact with different types of people and take up different challenges in the simulation lab of these co-curricular and extracurricular activities. You would see that when I took over in 2007, Symbiosis Law School Student Bar Association, by then also we had such brilliant gifted students, but we started sitting with students and they had enormous ideas, all the students giving ideas. Today, you name some of the top moots, Symbiosis Law School Pune students have made there, either as runners-up or winners, you know, all over in Australia in the Manfred Lax or in America in the two lead moots, whether it is in the UK in terms of media law or in terms of even client counseling, our students have made it. That's because of this consistent inspiration they draw from their seniors of the type that I mentioned. Therefore, it's very important to participate.
That's a wonderful, wonderful narrative and the illustration that you've just given. In fact, let me just go back to this one incident you narrated at the time your father was not very well and he was breathing his last. And you mentioned a point that when you went to meet him, you had some sort of an experience right before a jurisprudence exam. I would like to know about that experience because I think somewhere in the narrative that got lost. Because I'm a great believer in destiny. I'm a great believer in destiny.
Say about it because it will, see, on the one side we are talking like very practical, pragmatic, scientific people. On the other side, I think the paranormal experience is something that I think comes from your own mind and it's a different dimension of the mind.
Right.
Sometimes I think each one of us has the potential to reach that consciousness level. And for me, that was triggered in this last meeting in life with my father. That he made me stay in the hospital that night, and in the middle of the night I could see him watch over me. Then he said, now you go. and then I come back and then I have a dream, and in that dream it was very clear that I was preparing for the exam, and then my siblings come and tell me that he is waiting for you and he is really serious. And then in the dream I walk to the house. That house was a different house than where we were living, and then he falls into my lap and he says that I'll be reborn, you know, this is the dream. And then when the exam was coming closer, there were 2 days remaining, I was getting this little, you know, lubbed up kind of sound in the heart, the beating, because there was this premonition and there was this examination and there was this ailing father. So I called home, I packed my bag, I wanted to do a quick one night journey and come back. So I called, then my mother said, no, he's here. And in the phone, he said, hello, and he said, I'm okay. But he was roaming around in the courtyard. That, after speaking to me, I was in the bus. I had come halfway to Madikeri. It was another 3 hours. I got off the bus and got into the bus back to Mysore because I didn't want to miss my exam. And that night he expired. So this was something that was very strange, you know, that that experience made me feel that science is not everything. Science doesn't have all the answers. And that your mind can always sense a dimension which is beyond your physical existence. So we had in Mysore a lot of lamas, Dalai Lama followers, because Mysore is close to Bailakuppe, which has a Tibetan refugee camp. So I started attending some of the sessions with these lamas at the weekend. I had a very good friend of a lama. So I learned some basics about what happens after death and what happens to the soul. And of course, that journey continued. And now I have most of the answers. I think I have found most of the answers, that there is no beginning, no end. It is only a kind of transformation of the energy of the universe. Because chemistry, you know, thermodynamics, which Bhagavad Gita also says, that change in itself is permanent and nothing is permanent. Everything changes. So that change of consciousness vis-a-vis the body was something that I was battling with. So for years, I mean, almost 3 years, I had physical ailments because of this sudden experience and the shock and the inability to make sense out of it. So that's what I wanted to narrate. Of course, beyond that, again, I had his experience. How many years later? In 2011, 89 was my meeting with him closely. 2011, a dream meeting happened and he initiated in the dream. I think his first initiation was done in that last meeting in the hospital. This was 2011 when my responsibility with my son was almost getting over. He was entering teens. So I think in those periods I had undergone so many experiences. I married a law professor from Ireland. I had the opportunity of living in Ireland, learning about Irish mystics. And Professor Tim Murphy is also a spiritual voyager in his own right and way. He is deeply initiated into Buddhism in Thailand. So we led a kind of life which was into searching the meaning of life. So both of us used to talk about paranormal and all of that. Despite Tim being a strong advocate of natural rights in economic well-being of people. I mean, his background is from Warwick and another liberal university. And then he was teaching in Sheffield at the age of 21. He was a genius of a jurist. So Tim contributed a lot to the development of Irish constitution. So you can imagine. So what I have come to conclusion in 2011 is that this needs to be channeled into a core, and then everything else has to be aligned to that. Don't do anything which doesn't get approved by this core, and do everything which is benevolent. And try to see your entire life journey as a journey in benevolence and never the malice, and don't do anything which is not benevolent. So that is the message that I felt which could be simplifying this whole encounter for so many years, I thought. So by 2014 I met a guru, 11 itself I met a guru, he is no more. He was an astrophysicist from Tata Institute of Social Fundamental Sciences, who built a center in Vishakhapatnam. And the day I got the dream, he happened to be in Pune. I mean, this is what you call yoga yoga or synchronicity. So I kept an open mind. It was not easy to track his house. I went all the way to secretly. Nobody knew where I was going. I didn't want my driver to know. So I went, I met him, and he initiated into the final side of whatever my father had said in the dream. I continue that practice till today, and it's really, we call it as earthing the energy. It's earthing that experience. So this is how you normalize, because finally you have to live in this world. I believe that your presence is here for a purpose. Discover that purpose. The purpose is to do good to others. If you don't, then do something which will reach there, and to love others. So that's how I concluded it. So for me, the definition of love, as one of the American jurists said, justice is love in action. So I think our profession is the best way to convey to the world. Any profession for that matter has the core of public service, but I think our profession is the one which deals with many evils and fixes many evils, and always opens up the chances of equilibrium in the society by solving the problem for people. So lot of people put their dark energy, maybe in your office also. You have to heal yourself, as they say, as much as heal them by your advice, by your work. So I always wish the court was a little more progressive, a little more fast. I mean, those changes are coming. I mean, we have written a note to this e-justice project related note to Justice Chandrachud in evaluating it. So there are, I mean, when I was in the commission, we looked at best practices of the high courts, how one high court can learn or teach another high court, like Bombay.
Well, I'll come to that aspect also about the law commission. But thank you so much for highlighting this, because this is something I can personally relate to, because even when I was very young, I lost my mother, and I don't know about divine interventions and all, but sometimes in my dream, I think when I was growing up, you know, when I was in law school, I've had this feeling that, you know, she was visiting me and guiding me in a way. And sometimes I think things happen in life when they guide you in a way. And I think, you know, a very dear friend of mine just told me, you know, that life gives you, you know, what you need and not what you want. So somewhere I think there are, you know, guiding forces, guiding spirits, be it our forefathers, be it our friends, be it our well-wisher, be it the living and breathing spirits, you know, in terms of either human beings or others, you know, creatures around us. I think that is something very innate, and that is something I think we all need to believe, because anyone who has lost somebody, you know, in their close network, perhaps can relate to this, I'm sure. And I think that was my also mandate to, you know, ask you that question. And I think you have beautifully narrated how the quest for, you know, the whole quest for life, death, reason to be, existence has all been there, and how law as a profession beautifully can intricate, you know, all these solutions, if I may say so, put together in a journey of life. Having said that, ma'am, let me now come to our next phase. So, ma'am, we have just had a wonderful narrative from you, and now I would like you to, like our viewers, to you know, take a journey to the next phase of your life where you have done your LLM. Also, we would like to know, how did you decide to pursue PhD? And then, because you have had the benefit and the privilege of serving in so many law schools in the country, including the National Law School, and teaching in Ireland, and then also now heading one of the greatest private universities in India, Symbiosis Law School, for more than a decade. So I would like to know your journey from PhD and then to all these law schools in different jurisdictions that you have taught. And my question, the second question that I have for you is, because today, sometimes on LinkedIn and other social media platforms, and even in some webinars, young students ask me this question, that there is always an ongoing battle between national and non-national law school, markets treat them differently, so on and so forth. So we'll cover that also. But I would like to know your perspective first through your journey.
Yeah. See, when I was doing my master's, I did a dissertation on common heritage of mankind concept. That was the time I had not opened up to feminism so much, you know. So I took it for granted and I wrote my dissertation. Then the day I submitted my, this happens with all students, the day they submit their dissertation, they feel that emptiness. Then they come back to us and ask, when shall I do my PhD? So I did the same. I visited my sir in his residence in Mysore. And I asked him, sir said, don't hurry, publish little bit, teach little bit, then only you master the concept, then you think about PhD. So he delayed my PhD in a way. So by 1992, I was going to register. Till then, I did my one stint on civil service where I went up to the stage of interview, but then gave up. I didn't want to, I knew I was not cut out for that. Then I also did some other exam, NET exam. I cleared in one go. PhD at that time, Mysore University for some reason brought entrance exam. So I had to do the entrance exam and I cleared it. Then my official registration was by about 1994. Then it was going to be confirmed registration. See, it's funny, today UGC has adopted that practice. So I came to the batch which once had that. And then that year, I met a few thinkers. One was Professor Chimni Ingenu, another was Professor Jai Govind, who later became the Vice Chancellor of Bangalore National Law School. Then I met a few other professors like Professor Vishweshwaraya, etc., to find out what will be the most feasible area as far as India is concerned. And even Professor Coutinho was the one who said that, look at Europe, what is more relevant in Holland or other places which are liberal countries, that you do, because in years India is going to need all of that for this country. And he was quite good in that, he was very precise. Then Professor Jai Govind told, you pick a topic which brings your science knowledge in interface with law. So I was more interested in, Professor Chimney told, since you're good in feminism, why don't you look at feminism and human rights? Now I thought that, being a person of passion, if I got into feminism, I will never finish my thesis. But if I get into this common heritage of mankind, it's only abstract, it doesn't help people. So earlier I had one stint as a student of science in environmental movement. So there was this million club person, Mr. Benson. So we used to go to villages and plant trees and pick seeds, etc. So I decided to do in biodiversity law. That's how my PhD came about. Now the year I registered, I could not find a single journal written about it, no book written about it. But in the science area, there was so much being said. And in the policy area, there was so much being said. But in India, that consolidation was not happening. There was genetic engineering happening on the one side, marine geology and marine biology happening on another side. How do you synchronize it? Reading the convention, you don't get the idea. And that was the year I was in National Law School. I met him. Part of the reason why I was invited to join National Law School was my PhD topic, because they considered it as high tech topic. Somebody who is writing about high tech. So that's how it played a key role in my development. So when I went to Ireland, when I started speaking about science being regulated by law, it was like talking French in an English-speaking country. So they loved it. So they opened up all these databases and things. We had to put a requisition and we were getting articles. So all my data was collected in Ireland. And then I had the opportunity with him to visit Nottingham University Professor D.J. Harris, who is considered as a classic author in international law. Harris said, even now you can switch your PhD here. I said, no, I want PhD from my country, but which is of global standards. So I don't know why I was fanatical about proving to the world that India can do things which even West cannot imagine. So when they saw someone talking comfortably about science and law, they were very supportive. Then I finished my chapter by chapter. I came back to India, submitted it to Mysore University itself. I did not want my PhD from a Western university. That thesis is 99% of Western university thesis, but I wanted to do it for my country. So after I submitted the thesis, alongside my submission of thesis, my son was growing up. I was putting my full-time career in cold storage. So 2 years I took a full-time job in Manipal Institute of Communication, Mahe, to teach ethics and law to the journalists. And at that time I developed the other profile of political communication, culture and communication, and started linking it with the policy and law. So my publications mostly came at that time in that area. But biodiversity related one publication where I connected European and American trade dispute to the whole world of biotechnology policy, that caught the attention of a book publisher, and it was published as a chapter. Now reading that chapter, Edinburgh University gave me a visiting fellowship. So I went to Edinburgh Law School's AHRB, special fellowship was granted to me. There I was meeting Gus and others who are from WTO. So we were able to link biotech into WTO. So this is how the whole journey from PhD it started, where I linked all my life's people's movement. For example, I was involved in a people's movement where they were preserving traditional cultivation methods in near my village. Our own home was a home for experimenting with different types of traditional hybrids. So I was seeing how this knowledge was being lost, which was there in biodiversity convention as traditional knowledge. And my luck was good. Again, yoga, synchronicity. 2000, the whole Haldi and other controversies erupted. So that was the most timely moment for my thesis to go in. So 2000 I submitted, 2001, 2002 it was adjudged. So I was to give a public viva. That was also very first in my student. Today everybody does the public viva. So 8 discipline people attended my viva, right from biodiversity, biotechnology, engineering, political science, literature. So that was one of its kind in Mysore. They said that nobody's viva was attended. Even journalists came because they enjoyed asking questions. And I was talking, and the research that I had developed with this exposure to Europe was so topical and important that I was invited as a resource person to every university grants commission sponsored training in political science, in management, in literature, then in history, so most of the humanities subject, and in law. So this is how the whole journey, you know, people think once they do PhD, it's a kind of a crown for a researcher. No, your research begins with PhD. So I started experiencing how PhD became my passport to the larger world of knowledge. So around that time, I got a Ford Foundation project, not directly related, but about NGOs, how NGO management is done. After that, I got this Edinburgh Fellowship. Then because of that fellowship, I met a professor who was writing a book on medical law and ethics, where a medical doctor and a lawyer and an ethicist were together. So that opened up an idea of how to look at medical ethics in India. That's how my Middle East job happened. So PhD opens so many gates, and we must know that ancillary to the core, there are so many other windows which open. I tell all my doctoral students in my classes, and it is in the Middle East that Symbiosis top management met me and invited me to their university. This is how life takes, you know, that once you have an identity and self-definition around your expertise, you are wanted. But if you are not an expert in that subject with your hard work and your deep reading and deep scholarship, then I think you do not resonate with the new opportunities. Opportunities come to everyone, but spotting those or opportunities coming in search of you happens when you are ready to receive it with your preparedness, as they say. But I must also tell you that what happened after joining Symbiosis was something of a miracle. With all my experience, I was given a forum. So I gave my 101% to that. I had one resource here. First thing I did, put all my people together and I said, how do we brand? How do we take this brand further? So discursive moments with the colleagues on how to take it to the next level, what are the possibilities, and giving those possibilities in a presentation was something which was never heard of in a law school. It is like taking my company and my business to the next level. So I was using the business language in a legal education context without disturbing the core aspect of justice and public service. Two, clinical courses were being taught like a theoretical course. That was the way in which legal education was taken. Whereas you were asking the question, the college where I graduated, my principal being a dedicated lawyer, he had made us also fresh LLMs to go to the court 2 days a week. And he said, don't lose touch, that's your lab. So here I see all my teachers doing even practical training like a fiction. So I said, no, nothing doing, we have to go to the court. They said, the students don't speak Marathi. Let's pick the Marathi speaking students and make them the team leaders. Let them go to the court. Or during their internship, they will go and they will do these kinds of things which will pile up to become their clinical record. Right. So putting clinical legal education in the core, which I learned from my mentor, Dr. Madhav Menon, we got clinical legal teaching as a faculty development program within 4 months of my coming. And then that opened up a lot of, I mean, teachers were already doing some clinical stuff. So they knew what was relevant. They knew what to build on. Then we started doing separate clinical skills related special workshops. We had a cascade program because two of my faculty by then, one was from NUJS, Dr. Bindu, who is my deputy now. She had been sent by NUJS for that British Council sponsored program in Cardiff University. And one of my own senior faculty had gone. So we put them together. We cascaded it to other law schools so that we are known. That is one way of branding, you know, that you are a leader in the locality. No national law school had done that. So we did that. So like that, you know, we were very carefully nurturing the brand. ऑन द वन हैंड टू सेट अवर हाउस इन सच ए वे दैट इट बिकम्स द बेस्ट, ऑन अनदर साइड प्लेइंग ए की रोल फॉर द अंडर प्रिविलेज लॉ स्कूल्स. एवरी ईयर व्हेन आई टेक आउट वीड आउट माई बुक्स आई मेक स्टूडेंट्स टू पुट इट इन ए बेनिफिशियरी काइंड ऑफ कबर्ड एंड वी ट्रांसपोर्ट इट टू अंडर प्रिविलेज रूरल लॉ स्कूल्स इन द कॉर्नर्स ऑफ सोलापुर एंड ऑल दीज महाराष्ट्र रूरल एरियाज. We train their teachers, we invite them to conferences, and we try to do legal aid in Marathi language with them to the clientele who approach us. So this kind of networking and leadership role, if it is played, then you become de facto national law school. But there is a difference because national law schools are fully deemed universities. So national law schools need to focus more on research. A university is known for knowledge creation. But the nature of our undergraduate program being a professional program compels them also, like us, to emphasize undergraduate education. But today, if you see, the research leadership of Symbiosis Law School is very high. We got the European grant in 2005, which I did some kind of, you know, we call it as outcome-based or performance-based approach. So we became the core partners because of the innovation we brought in. German university said, you lead now. So this is how we stretched the project till 2012. By that time, we had some DART grants and I became the Fulbrighter. Then we had Australian participation, New Zealand participation. So by 2016, we were identified for the Eurasia grant. Of course, there we had Jindal also as our partner. Today, there's a big conference going on. We are finishing that grant. Meanwhile, we became eligible for three other grants on climate change, international migration, and 21st century skills. We are creating a 21st century lab. Government of India is speaking now for CBSE, the 21st century, whereas our concept of 21st century is much bigger, much wider, and we are creating an online, offline kind of platform to train the teachers. So this we are doing in collaboration with Banasthali in India and Greek Ionina University in the lead. And there are many other universities outside from Lithuania. And then also we have from China and Cambodia, you know, participating with us. So now we have this network, not just being friendly, but being collaborators in training, in research, in teaching, in knowledge creation. So overall, it gave such dividends, rich dividends. This year, we were competing in FICCI's internationalization competition for something like law, which is closely bound up with governance, therefore territorialized. We had the best internationalized institution award, competing with technology, competing with the other, you know, liberal arts institutes, etc. So our management, which are translatable globally, whereas for a law school, it's not easy, and law school, it's not easy. We did it. So what we started in 2007, prior to that with my colleagues initiative in 2005, today culminated in that ultimate possibility. It's not that we have to rest on this, but we are looking at the next level in terms of co-tutelé PhD, in terms of we created a specialized LLM in European legal studies. We created a European legal courses to be opted by students. We have a value-added course on European legal studies. This is one, but we have area studies in Asia. Now we want to look at Africa as well, because we have collaboration with South African professors. We want teachers to come here, students are going there, teachers are going there. I mean, 3/4 of my faculty have had exposure internationally teaching and researching and trained also. This Eurasia program had a 21-day training in Italy, then in Poland, then in Bulgaria. All my faculty got exposure to that. They were enjoying it. Even my Noida Law School director is a very internationalized person. My Nagpur director, my Hyderabad team, all of them are beneficiaries of this. Primarily we do it, then we mentor our other law schools. So this is how our relationship is going, you know. So it is here that I again emphasize to students, PhD is not for vanity. It is not for putting that prefix in your name. It is a huge commitment that you will lead the life of a truth seeker. Research is truth seeking. So your knowledge is only limited till you push the boundaries of that knowledge, till you impact lives. So PhD is an ever learning kind of process. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am, because as you rightly said, it's where the research journey starts. You know, it's not the end of the research journey. I think that's the best takeaway from me and for our young viewers also. But the next question that I have for you is One, because Symbiosis in itself is such a prestigious university, and now you know, nationwide you have law schools in Noida, in Hyderabad, and in other places of Maharashtra also, Nagpur. In fact, I have the benefit to give one of the webinars, I think this year, a month ago, I was invited to speak on cyber law and cyber security. So I was there. But my question is, ma'am, there is a lot of debate today in terms of lesser privileged law school, and so far as when we say a national law school and a non-national law school. And when we speak of non-national school, I do not mean all the private universities here, but because of the mushrooming of the law colleges and law school, which has happened, I think, in the past 10, 15 years more so, because when the vision of National School Bangalore was created, the mandate was very clear that a world-class quality education dealing in 5 years of law schooling and young, bright minds would be there. But today there are two things. One, this debate between a national and a non-national law school. The second question that I have for you is this aspect of a three-year law degree and a five-year law degree, because I think our nation is one of those unique nations offering both these courses. Do you think there's a dichotomy there, or can we just iron out these differences and make one law course, maybe perhaps for, let's say, 3.5 years or 4 years, whereby 1 year can be saved? I'll throw this question open to you.
Yeah, wonderful. See, now you are aware of new education policy. Under the new education policy, I think this kind of a fanatical argument of throwing away the three-year law course, which is postgraduate kind of law course, will be running contrary to the diversity of our country. I will come to that point later. But I want to highlight this point, national law school, non-national law school dichotomy. Now, this national law school, non-national law school dichotomy was created at a particular phase of evolution of legal education. I think it is a currency which has lost its rationality, but it is nurtured or banked in its subscription. By subscription, I mean some of the law firms even now go by that kind of a thing. But later on, they regret that the national tag itself is no guarantee of a good product. But the disservice we do, you are molding in 5 years in a particular institute may transform you, but it may not transform who you are in the core, or it may not transform you to fully become a good individual. So it applies across the board, whether it is Symbiosis or National Law School. Therefore, let us not limit an individual's signification just to the educational institution where they are shaped. That individual who is shaped in National Law School may be doing well because that individual already had it to make it in the tough competition to enter that law school in the intellectual side. But then there are those who have entered that law school may not be in that meritorious echelon of the student body, but they have done well in life being good people. Now, show me how many of our law schools have produced good parliamentarians. It is again Delhi University itself, or how many good judges they have produced? Again, Delhi University. Or maybe my Symbiosis Law School produced one Revati Mohit Dere or Sadhna Zadav, who are creating waves in the Mumbai High Court. So that is my prestige. Or the old college where I studied and taught in the beginning of my life produced a great judge like Justice Nazir. So if you credit a law school in its 20 plus years of existence not having a significant contribution to country's judiciary or country's original innovative legal practice. Of course, some of the products have done this recent transgender right litigations and things like that out of their personal commitment. I don't deny that, but I feel still it is a minuscule. It is, look at the origin, I mean the investment that government has made on these law schools. That's why Karnataka government said that it hasn't made much of a contribution to my state, so I'm withdrawing my grants. Right. So now you have very little grant coming from Karnataka government. So this kind of a reversal is being seen at the levels of those who supported this movement, but still our industry seems to be going by that. If the industry has got certain strict yardsticks which are not biased, which are not determined by the alumni of these law schools, which are going by what we call as competency or traits required for that job, I don't think it will remain the same. Therefore, time has come for us to validate our young demography, 65% demography, and their dreams and their aspirations and meritocracy of this country for an efficiency. And sometimes maybe merit may be even defined in terms of emotional quotient. I mean, today with artificial intelligence and other things coming up, this kind of approach, how it is updated, when the COVID crisis hit, look at the way the entrance exams were conducted, or switching over to online was done. It took ages for these national law schools to adopt, because they were very happy in their pride and in their own little niches. We were also too proud that we were doing everything well, but we had to, I mean, work day and night to adapt ourselves. You know, universities like us and Jindal, who had done everything in the private sphere on our own, we were more prepared, because for us it was thriving, surviving. If our market was going from our hand, if our client was going away, customer was going away from our hand with distrust and disservice, we couldn't be recovering so soon. Now, that kind of comfort which a government-funded institution has, no matter what, let me decide after 6 months. You know, some of them not even have their results even now in some of the state universities. So your question on underprivileged law schools and their future, if you are asking about, I say that there is a need for Bar Council, or whichever is the body that Government of India will create. I hope we have a body like Medical Service Commission, Medical Education Commission, coming for legal education, where Bar Council will play a very key role in terms of profession related dimensions. I'm sure that this will solve, this will put those agenda, and new education policy is complementary to that, because new education policy has this idea of satellite universities, satellite colleges, where a lead college will have satellite of other colleges where improvement is done. I must tell you, at the higher education, there is this new experiment which is coming up called mentoring of institutions. So a lead institute will be required to mentor some of the other institutes. So Symbiosis International University and some of our colleges are considered as mentors for some of the local colleges. So that we have been doing through the Government of India's regulation itself. So this needs to be more structured within the law schools, because law schools are a tribe by themselves, because they are professional colleges which have a professional council. So there we need policy changes, whichever is the, I mean, core policy change is who has to regulate, because now Bar Council thinks it can regulate LLM, whereas we have a UGC which is supposed to be regulating PhD and post-graduation. So we have a lot of overlapping territories which need to be clarified by policies. So that will determine. Your next question on 3-year and 5-year law course. I am a product of 3-year course. I tell you, in our times, we didn't have structured mooting, we didn't have internship. One mooting was held not to disappoint the students, because when I was finishing my degree, 5-year law course started entering in the college. So they had to keep them occupied. So we competed with the 5 years in the mooting. But mooting became more structured with the 5 years themselves taking the lead. So I'm talking of the time before Bar Council's 2008 rule. 2008 rule of Bar Council is pretty good. It talks about streamlining all these things. It's a very comprehensive one. The best practices of National Law School, Bangalore, NALSAR, and us, and all of us have been incorporated into this rule, which gives elective subjects, honors courses, multiple possibilities are there. Little bit of choice for students according to their interest and need is given. Now, compared to that, 3-year law course is not a serious law course, it is perceived to be. But we were serious students of 3-year law course. I spent all my day in the law school reading, writing, participating. So what I mean to say is that we have two options in front of us. I agree with you that this 5-year law course is not going to be practical down the line, because you are neither a postgraduate nor are you fully graduate. So you can always, I mean, our students now with their self-learning and with the COVID, the possibility should be stronger with their flipped classrooms. They should be able to absorb as many courses as possible. So we can do in 3 years, like how in England and Ireland, we used to have BCL courses. So Bachelor of Civil Law courses, we can have Bachelor of Law course, which can qualify them to the bar after they do. See, those 3-year law course, those 3-year graduates after 12th, they did not directly enter the bar. They had to do the bar exam. They had to do 1 year mentorship. You know, we used to call it as dinners, bar dinners. And then you can appear for the bar, you know, or you can be a solicitor by doing articleship with the solicitor, or what they called apprenticeship with the solicitor, and then pass these exams. So we can make that mandatory, where Bar Council can play a very crucial role. So that apart, the clear debate between 3-year and 5-year, again, new education policy says India's demographic dividend is very important. This huge young demography should be reaping the development benefit. Now, my answer to that is, I mean, even in three education policy, they have emphasized lifelong learning should be possible. So if you're talking about lifelong learning in law, do we look at law graduates only to be qualified for practice? Or is practice age specific? I think practice is age neutral. And LLB is also age neutral. Legal education is age neutral. Time and again, Supreme Court has given the clarity that age bar should not be there in pursuing the law. Now, brain processes, neurological investigations have told that human brain is a malleable thing. With the age, there are certain nuances, but I think learning cannot be stopped at any age. The more you learn or the more you engage in learning, it's healthy for you. Human brain works better when it is exercised, like human muscles. Therefore, there is no scientific basis. I mean, I would not accept anything which is unscientific. So just because some three-year law course or most of the three-year law course students came to three-year law course because they wanted a promotion in banking or they wanted a promotion in Pune, it was for defense, because our law school also started as a three-year law course. Now, on the other hand, look at ranking of the law schools. Top four or five rank comes to IIT Kharagpur, which is running an exclusive three-year law program on intellectual property rights. So I used to run a three-year law program till 2003 before I took over. They stopped it because they wanted the serious fire. It must be Dr. Menon and others pursuing it. And now what happens? Three-year law course students who graduated at that time only are the ones to be told. So when I entered the big new campus, which we earned by our good work and branding, in 2014, we had lot of space. Between 2007 and 14, I had made my own notes where I had every year at least 50 phone calls. Why can't you start your three-year law course again? Most prestigious graduates from engineering colleges, they were not finding a place in IIT Kharagpur or our neighboring ILS law college. So I decided, now in the new campus I have space, let me revive the three-year law course. First year batch was a difficult batch because we didn't have much of a rigor. One, I do agree, there is a psychological dimension. They can't be in the same premise as our young students because their mindsets are different. But I think young students will get to know good things also. Experiences are shared sometimes. So I think, don't they have negative people outside also? And then aren't there negative people among the fire law course also? So it's an ecosystem that you create, and the way in which you anticipate and handle these problems, you mentor. Now, from day one, I set goals in front of every student, 3 year, 5 year, LLM, and then have different streams identified, different team of coordinators handling them, and I review it. So I do agree with the rationality, but my 3 year law program has attracted IIM graduates, my own SABM graduates. It has attracted the best of the graduates from Sriram College, from the Hamsaraj College, all the lead colleges of Delhi, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, best students. So today if I have 60 students, I have a permission to run 120 capacity 3 year program, but I am limiting it to 60. Because I want to prove to my management, which is still hesitant, not convinced that 3 year can be serious and students can be decent. So I have had my 3 year student picked up by Supreme Court judge as a clerk. I have had one of them pursuing fully paid scholarship for masters in Finland. Another few are into practice. Some are in law firms. One girl got picked up by Trilegal. So it's producing very serious graduates. But poor things, when they go for internship or when they are presented for interview, they say, no, 3 years. My placement cell faces so much of trouble. So I told these students, you build on your existing strength. Why did you come to law? You are not like 5 year law course who want to do law per se. You already have something which is a core competence. Around that, to weave law, you will have niche jobs. So this is how I design their future goal. So if you ask me one sentence, should 3 years stay or go, I say it should stay. In our country, it should stay, because like my own story or many other story, people may discover their passion in law due to that life-changing event. We call it as personal pain area in research. So that could be the possibility. Second, they would have been pained. I mean, many times I asked students, you know, in my first lecture, director's address, why did you choose law? Is it because you watched a movie or Suits, you know, those serials? majority of them say, when I ask them a question, because of your some experience of injustice, large percentage of hands go up. That means in this country, anyone who feels that he or she is a victim of injustice or survivor of injustice, they would want to pursue law. They that way honor law. Call them in. They will do better in your law course because they are driven by their own motivation. So that is one. Third, I know one lead figure in one of the topmost law schools. I asked his personal journey because our Hyderabad law school opened in his neighborhood in a very remote area in Karimnagar district. This man told me he had to feed his family by working. In those days, you know, if you're a meritorious student, either a bank or telecom company will absorb you. So he was a meritorious student. He worked in the telecom industry for many years. And then in the evening law college, he did the three-year course. Then he did his LLM and went to JNU, did his PhD. Today he's a lead figure. He may become vice chancellor of any national law school soon. You know, because of his diversified approach, he introduced best of the courses, whether it is the area of aviation or it is the area of telecom or it is the area of Asian international relations. Nobody did that in any other law school. The innovation is because of his first professional life. So if anyone comes and sits in front of me face to face, I have got enough data, enough research to support our country, not only for the political reasons and socioeconomic reasons and the philosophy of lifelong learning in new education policy, but because of these empirical realities, should not give up on three-year course. And I asked national law schools, somebody asked one national law school, I think our judges also say no 3 years. Our judges, I mean, in Gujarat, somebody was asking, because Gujarat, you know, slowly is opening up a lot of things, and they were told that the chancellor or vice chancellor, chancellors are usually judges. So these judges are not very much in favor of national law schools opening up to 3 years. In their wisdom, it's right, because adult students, but then LLM students are adult students. The thing is, there are certain programs where both of them sit. So they say auntie is sitting, uncle is sitting. So imagine, I mean, it should be more painful for the students. And here we are regulating it from the management. So how do you do the serious 3 year student? So we introduced entrance exam. We also introduced a psychological test just to weed out the negatives. So we have a big personality, big five personality test, which whereby I have very standard admission. So everybody is asking how it is manageable, because the past, if you see in Pune or any city with the 3 years, is not a peaceful past. So I am doing it now. Jindal is doing. We don't have any issues because we are taking the serious student. So my 3 years is only 60. And first year I had 300 applications. Today 1,400 applications. And we have one special quota where it's like NRI quota, but that quota also gets filled. So I call Raj and I tell him, would you be open to take a student? Even if the fees with Raj is much higher than mine in Jindal, students want to do 3 year course. Serious students whose parents are professionals, or parents themselves are lawyers and they want their son to or daughter to do the law and support their practice and expand their practice in a higher level. They want to send their children to very good law schools, serious law studies they want to do instead of the state university in the neighborhood. So there is a demand. Therefore, my opinion is serious 3 year course like IIT Kharagpur is required.
That's a great reasoning and narrative, if I may say so. But I have a next question. It may be a trick question, but it's based from a student point of view, because many times when I'm conducting a webinar or doing seminars or even writing a post on LinkedIn, other social media, most of these young law students from different parts of the country, from different law school, have this basic question that our parents have put in so much of money, especially because the tuition fees in our country has gone up in all the law schools across the board, be it a national law school, be it a private law school. And then there is a problem of finding a job, because there is a huge disconnect between the availability of jobs in the market and the amount of law school being churned out of institutions. So that's a practical difficulty. How can we bridge that? Because to my mind, and I may be ignorant in that, and please correct me if I'm wrong, there is no data available to us as to how many jobs are actually available in the market. Is the market already saturated? Because when we say market, we are only looking at law firms or perhaps some in-house. But when we speak of litigation, there is a whole dispute of how a litigating lawyer has to build their own practice. And I keep saying this many times to law students that most of the law school do teach us the business law aspect, but nobody teaches us the business of law aspect as to how a business is conducted by a law firm, you know, or a litigation chamber. And if those things are not taught to the students, you know, or the market is not turned face to face, as in between a prospective employer and an employee, then we'll always have this problem and a huge disconnect between different institutions being being open in the country, be it any law school. I'm not naming any institution here, but because we have seen this in BTEC, we have seen this in MBA, and I'm sorry to say this, but I think somewhere the legal industry is also now facing this problem of having huge churn of students who are now literally looking for jobs, and they don't have jobs even for 2 years or 4 years after graduation. And what is your take on that?
See, what we do when they arrive in the first year itself, we have these mentorship. So teachers mentor 10 students. I don't know about my colleagues, but I have given them the structure on how to arrive at this process. So we have a commonality. So what question we ask, what is the goal with which you came? So invariably, there are four types of goals. One is practice. In that practice also, there is variation. Some want to do exclusively corporate law practice. Some want to continue with their parental practice. Some don't mind being in their taluka place. So this is one set. Second set is those who want to go to judiciary. Third is one who wants to have a mix of corporate law and corporate practice. And then they want to branch out into something specific. Then the fourth is who want to earn higher degree and live abroad. Then there is a minuscule of the people who want to run their own NGO or own company. So then I started doing my studies again. So in that middle chunk, I mean, if you are looking at court-based practice, which is more litigation, there are, you know, there are some 10 avenues in that. What are those avenues? Prosecution is there. Then you have these tribunal case management jobs are there, court management, ministerial officers. Then you have, after 1 or 2 years of struggling in the court, you can always take a kind of shift to what they call as a law officer job. Then there are public service commissions, various openings. These days, everywhere they need a law assistant. Then Advocate General's office, Supreme Courts have paid kind of clerkships these days. So when I lined it up, in litigation sector itself, there were few jobs. If these students are trained in a competitive way, they will get those jobs. That is one. Now, the second is the law firms. Law firms also have very unique type of jobs. And we have in law firms also first year, second year, third year and others. Others are very small groups, but they pay a decent salary, you know. Students should not always dream of trilegal, SAM, CAM, who pay a hefty pack. So, these come to the campuses, but nowadays they come a lot to Symbiosis because of the leadership qualities our kids have and resilience that they have and less of attitude. But they have limitation also. Some of our students are not at all serious about research. So whenever research is required, which is a research-based job, is always chamber practice, there they may go for lead law schools or they may pick only one from mine. But when it goes to legwork, when it goes to working in interdisciplinary teams, they pick our students. So that is the second type of diversity that I saw. Within the law firm itself, there are 3-4 verticals. So in 3-4 verticals, there are different skill sets. I have done my little analysis on that. So every time I gear my curriculum, my pre-placement training to these. Then, you know, you have these corporate law jobs where you have different sectors. Nowadays, winning sector is aviation. Then you have this construction. Then you have this infrastructure. You have banking, insurance. So multiple actors, you know, lot of non-banking financial companies, lot of banking companies, lot of non-scheduled banks. So many jobs are coming up. Aside from that, you have securitization and other asset reconstruction, those new avenues. So we train students, we have our curriculum connected to that. But just before their job readiness comes in the fourth year, I started in the fourth year, we start seeing that their internships are also geared in those choices that they have. We show them choices. We renew it every time. So their internships are structured in that way every semester so that it is developmental. And then they take plan A, plan B, sometimes up to plan C. Then there is this one group, at least 3 to 4 in a class, who want to have their small business. So they run a business when they are in college. I had one student who used to have a turnover of 13 lakhs in a restaurant, which he was collaborating with someone and running in a nearby area and supplying the students in the night when no other supplier will be available, very reasonable food. So that is one example. Second one example is where somebody was aggregating agricultural technology, somebody was doing artificial intelligence. So lot of our students are into that. So now I'm running an entrepreneurship cell, which has got a mentoring by our management college, because at the university level we have an innovation center. So we invite the director of that to talk to the students. So a lot of them are developing their business ideas as well, girls and boys. Then we have family-based, those who have a backup in the family, who mostly, I must tell you, the students who are coming to Symbiosis Law School, except maybe 20 to 30%, rest of them have their life made. So I cater to, out of my 300 batch, I know that only when I ask them to opt for placement, only 240 opt for placement. They take the training, but they get PPOs. They get pre-placement offers based on their internship. No law firm nowadays, most of them don't want to come to campus. They want to train and watch the student. And fitment they want to check, which is right, you know, which is very rational. So campus-based placement dimension is shrinking now. But the way to prepare is that you prepare their, you know, where one individual differs from the other. Everyone has similar amount of gray matter. It is in emotional and attitudinal approach. So it is the attitudinal and emotional side which we try to shape here. That is why you can see that such a big law college, such a big number, 4 times, 5 times compared to an average national law school, still being peaceful because of this orientation that we create a very work addictive environment and loving work and being very presentable. You see the presentability of Symbiosis Law School students, ability to live independently, because they are not in a residential school where they eat only the hostel food and only socialize with themselves. They go out, they do a lot of things. So overall, what I'm coming to is law jobs, as how we define law jobs, should be very broadly looked at. And law should be looked at as a discipline and as an aptitude, which is mandatory for every organization. So we should not only look at court-centric practice. I tell you, High Court and Supreme Court are highly competitive, most of the high courts. And court-centric jobs, I told you how many varieties are available. But if you're looking at law practice in a tier 2 or tier 3, tier 4 city, there are certain families who have made it into a fiefdom. So, and there are caste criteria, there are historical criteria, there are judge-related criteria, which make this practice more person-centric than merit-centric. So keeping a hope and optimism in students and training them in aptitude, I think every organization. Did you read that report? Even during COVID, you know, when people were fired, leadership figures were not fired because they know that without leadership, it cannot function. So every law graduate who is well trained is a potential leader. And what is missing in India, which is only 8% aptitude available in India, is the leadership. Now, that is where our law graduates should be fully making use of this opportunity and also training themselves. Another thing, we have a very rigid mindset in this day and age also. You don't need to have your mentor from your own law school. You can always have a mentor from another law school. You can have a mentor from profession. See, we all believe, I mean, I have my informal mentors in many ways. As I told you, Justice Nandrajog was one of the mentors. So indirectly, Justice Dhananjay Chandrachud is also a kind of a friend who mentors. I have Dr. Muzumdar, who is our university's chancellor, as a mentor in some sense. I have mentoring constantly being taken by me from a lot of my colleagues also, peers also, like Purvi in Nirma or Raj in Jindal. So we share our views. And I have one strong mentor, but a very strong friend whose son also studied here in Pankaj Mittal, who was once the vice chancellor of a women's university. So there is a lot of mutual mentoring also which goes on, you know. So students will have to look at one professional mentor from the time they start interning. About 6 to 8 internship opportunities they get minimum. So that time they can pick one person with whom they resonate well, tune well, and their life ambition is very much having common with that person, and keep going to that person and also do a kind of review of oneself. that it is the alter ego of yours where you evaluate yourself. You know, that's what new education policy says. Shift from teaching to coaching. Become a mentor. So I started introducing that, and we do a lot with our peers also. We do a lot with our students also. And nowadays what is happening, many students want individual mentoring irrespective of their teachers. So they come to me through their parents or some friends or someone. It's not that someone who approaches only I do. Sometimes I feel if somebody has a problem in understanding and being lost, they suddenly write to me. I don't know where my interest is. I'm interested in this, but I'm not interested in that. So I give them 2 to 3 days constant talking and finding out and getting the data of their scores in the exam, their internship pattern. So in 10 minutes, you are able to know how their personality is, what are their strong areas, what are the A, B, C possibility. So this is a skill which is the HR skill, which many lawyers don't learn from their profession. But it comes by experience or very structured orientation. I was trained by a global trainer when I was in the Middle East assignment. So we understand it immediately, the activist personality, the thinking personality, and the executive personality. An executive personality is a good combination of activist and thinking. That's what we do, leaders. So most of the lawyers are executive personality, in my opinion, because they apply their knowledge. Because profession is about execution. So we don't seem to see this. See, once upon a time in India, a lot of respect was there for doctors. And it was doctors who were chosen for leadership in the society, for parliamentarian roles and all. You know why? Because people trusted those who advised them. People trusted those who used knowledge to serve them. So our profession also had the same credibility. That's how during independence, all those leaders who played a key role were lawyers. So I think we need to reiterate our position of leadership and qualities of leadership. I tell you, one avenue where there is so much of dearth of good people, that is academics. I invite so many retired judges, retired or senior lawyers, and mix match my curriculum to have that practical edge. And many of my brilliant students get disillusioned in practice after 4 or 5 years. They want to come back here teaching, if not to me, to some other law school, but they keep in touch and they take references to go abroad and all. So this is happening now, and this should happen more. We need more hands to train our graduates who may not be only court-centric career. There are other careers. So I'll tell you the story. I redesigned our placement cell, which has got now the recruitment as a vertical, which always had a recruitment focus. But we started doing the training and development from translating curriculum-based knowledge into job-based knowledge built on their internship and interest. And then we have another vertical which is looking at skills and entrepreneurship. The fourth one is the reviewing their performance and their career shaping. Now, we see our students from the beginning, how they came in as a product when they turn out. There's a lot of attribute that they acquire. So last, despite the COVID challenge, because of our recruitment drive going very strong, and our, as you rightly said, even though we don't have a formal structured study, we did some informal study by surveys. So we were able to find 25% increase in the placement. We created it. Like instead of 140 jobs, which I would usually dispense, I was able to go up to 160. This year I have gone 20% more. So this is how we want to achieve that. But for that, your base database also should be strong. Your research should be strong. Where is the trend going? And then your PR also should be strong, where you have good industrial relations. And most of our feeders of jobs are our alumni themselves, who are leading in these organizations and who find new avenues. And their own offices, when they shift from their job to create their new office, they always come back to us to recruit their new colleagues. So these are the various ways by which we can increase the visibility and opportunity for our graduates.
I think that's a very nice answer. In fact, my takeaway is how all of us, the stakeholders, was to say, should join hands and must join hands, whether it be giving back to the society in terms of academia, or as you rightly said, you know, you and I've seen personally that inviting judges, serving or retired, you know, inviting people who are in active practice, be it law firm partners, be it practicing lawyers. I think it's very important to bridge this gap by everyone performing the symbiotic relationship. If I can say so, but having taken a lot of your time, just a penultimate question here. that we are all suffering in this different waves of COVID. We don't know whether a third wave is coming or not coming. But how do you see this pandemic changing the face of education in the country, especially legal education, and more so in the light of so many legal tech or edutech companies now trying to foray into the field of online education, so many online certificates being given, courses being offered left, right, and center. Sometimes people are disillusioned. They don't know which course to prefer, which course not to prefer. They are paying money from their parents' hard-earned income. And sometimes they are not sure whether this particular certificate, this particular degree, or this particular diploma, whatever it may be called, is going to land them with a short job opportunity or even an internship opportunity later, should that materialize. So I would like to know your thoughts on a post-pandemic world, as and when this is behind us, the future of legal education in India.
Wonderful question. And I have been reading the American reports also about how legal education, legal profession, both are going to change in the post-pandemic scenario. I don't know when that post is, but I saw when the first phase came, I had told my students, those of you who are missing some of the skills experience, direct skills experience, we will invite you. Once this ends in 6 months, you will come for 15 days, do that, and then fulfill your gaps. That invite never could go. We invited and we halted because the second wave hit us very badly. So in the light of that, I would agree with you that post-pandemic legal education is going to be different. We have already proven that. During pandemic, we coped with it. See, some of us who were already ready with our mandatory blended learning, mandatory online course integration or embedded in our curriculum, we thrived very well. We found the transformation switch over in 2 days to the leftover teaching that was hit by pandemic. But those of us who are not, we still are not, I mean, some of the state university law schools and all, they're still not following up the academic year. Some of my students are finding it difficult. So it's going to be like technology is going to be part and parcel of the post-pandemic legal education. I tell you, Bar Council put a condition that at least 1/4 of the law students should have a lab facility. Means we should have a computer lab, which will account for 1/10 of the students at least. And the timetable should show who is using, when are they using. But in the post-pandemic world, now Bar Council doesn't have to see. Students will demand, or they will bring their laptops or mobile phone, because now converging technology is available with the mobile telephony. So teachers will have to keep pace with the technology. We trained the teachers to good enough to teach, but still most of them, in our institute, it's a different story, but I see people doing all these webinars and all, how to face the camera, how to adjust the camera, how to talk to the mic. I mean, there is a lot of soft skills which are required for teachers to play a perfect role. Now it is okay because it is a temporary interim kind of measure, no study or some kind of study kind of option. But in the post-pandemic scenario, technology is going to be playing a key role, making students, convincing students and bringing them back to the normalization process is going to take a lot of effort. We already had back to school kind of sessions every semester with the psychiatrist sitting with us, and hundreds of questions by parents and students. Obesity is growing, so our gyms will have to be fully active. We already have basic fitness as a mandatory course. Students hate it. They say that I don't know how to put up those hours. I said, in your high school you did. The problem is, see, when they enter these prestigious law schools, they sit for their grinds, tuitions. So in a way, they lose their sporting habits. They lose their hours in the open ground and even socializing, etc. So that is going to be a challenge. Fitness is going to be a challenge. I would certainly see many of them falling prey to obesity, because any long hour in front of the screen will make you have a lot of other issues scientifically. Then even the social apathy is a danger, that you are so used to being on your own, now suddenly spending time with others. I mean, I still remember when I first lived in the West in mid-90s, I was finding people's habits very strange. Nobody on the street, they're happy in their little shells. How could they be happy? How could they be happy on their own for whole day, whole week, etc., were my intriguing questions. And then I used to explain to my relatives, it must be because they had undergone something like COVID. So COVID makes me understand what is the panic that a society goes through when they have something like this. You know, they had Spanish flu, So that had left deep imprints that the more you get closer to crowds, you could become susceptible to these things. So be on your privacy. If you are not well, care for others, therefore don't carry the infection. So a lot of our students will learn a lot of new things and come back. But when they come back, how they will adjust, then our earlier normal will become the new normal for them because they are used to this normal. So taking them off technological addiction also will be a challenge, I feel. We will have to go forward with blended learning maybe for another year because international people may not come because COVID is not disappearing uniformly from the face of the countries. So we will have to carry on online learning and online assessment. When you do that for them, you can't deprive our students. There won't be what we call level playing field. So this is the forecast in the short term of next 1 or 2 years. But beyond that, I think we will have a generation which will be more used to self-directional study, which who will blend on their own and mix match their own degrees, some from online, some from offline. That's why in anticipation, we made Coursera sign up with us. And then we are offering Coursera courses free of charge to the students, whereby that will be incorporated and embedded into our assessment and learning. So we have mapped some of the Coursera courses and we are offering them to our students. This is because we are going to see a future where students may not visit the law school because they have all those options available. So it is better we show them that it is possible to align, but this is more important. Now, last thing I would like to tell, forever online cannot be a substitute for offline in our discipline because large percentage of skilling is about soft skill. They say that in CA, in law, 85% of the success is on soft skill, 15% is on the knowledge. You cannot grow soft skill by sitting with a machine. You have to have organic human behavior, observed and what we call observed and tuned to cultivate your own skills. Therefore, my conclusion is that it is going to be a future of blended learning without disappearance of offline learning, at least for some time. But in another 20 years, it may unfold in a different way.
I think, ma'am, that's a great takeaway, and it's a wait and watch for all of us because it's as I say, your guess is as good as mine. Whether it be judiciary or academia, we still have to take one day at a time and decide when this pandemic is behind us. But just before I wrap up, I wanted to touch upon your stint with the University Grant Commission, UGC, which is a very important body in our country. And my question is a little different because you have been a part of a body which reviews the laws and the lawmaking process in the country. And sometimes people within the family, within our colleagues, ask us who are not lawyers that our country has too many laws. We need to simplify the process of justice. We need to simplify the process of lawmaking. Just a quick takeaway, from your experience and how we can simplify this whole process. Because many a times, as lawyers, as stakeholders in this system, we are blamed that we are making things complex rather than simplifying them. And I'm a firm believer that as lawyers or as law students, our job is always to simplify things rather than, making it more complex.
I agree with you. See, a communicator like you, who is talented, will say that it should simplify. Other day, I was reading a sentence by one of my law colleagues, 6-line sentence. You should not have a sentence more than 5 words or 6 words if you go by communication process. Secondly, why should you use legal jargon all the time? So we should have a law in the legal language in order to have that correspondence with the existing other legislations in the company of other rules, the whole interpretation principles. But simplifying a law in ordinary people, like I translated CEDAW into Kannada language and Tulu language, and I talked about it in the villages. So we have to do this job of bringing law closer to people because our lawmaking process operates through the representatives of people who themselves may not have basics of law. So our law institutions, like law schools, have a large role to play. We researchers have a large role to play. When I was on the commission, a large percentage of contributors were lawyers. You know why? Because they knew the law in its dynamic context, lively context. We had B.V. Acharya, we had also other legislators like Achyutan, some politicians, lawyer turned politicians also in our commission. But I was the only lady member. So when 498A was being discussed all of them spoke from their prejudicial point of view. So finally, I had half the house turned against that kind of prejudice, and it had to take them sociological knowledge, output of that law, impact of that law, and domestic violence as a gendered experience. Now, by this example, I'm trying to show you that all the lawmakers are also not prejudice-free, or they do not know what exactly is happening at the grassroots in the society. Therefore, institutions like us, researchers like you, have a larger role to play. So I have introduced in our legal research methods what Professor Menon popularized in the mid-90s, community-based law reform exercise. After that, a lot of competitions have been held. Menon sir himself was running a competition on uniform civil code. So what is this community-based law reform? Students will be learning the law, but they unlearn when they look at the people and they try to find out from people what their reality in relation to that particular law is. For example, divorce or triple talaq. And then they come back and read the law again. They'll be able to see how this law is not containing this provision at all, or existing provision is inadequate. Then they find out those areas. Then they relearn it in the light of the data that they have collected from the society and suggest reforms, recommendations. So this kind of a community-based reform, the word community there need not be, it is one share of stakeholders. And these stakeholders range from lawyers to judges to community of litigants to NGOs to ordinary citizens. So these 5 to 7 stakeholders, I make it mandatory for all PhD students, after they put their doctrinal reflection from the top of their head and doctrinal study, I tell them, have one chapter where you are validating your conclusions from the stakeholders. They have to go. 50 to 100 opinions they bring. Again, the methodological feature is there. So this is how we have to bring law, any academic exercise, closer to the community. See, you guys are doing it as lawyers because your client is a live entity. But we don't do it in academics, nor do the judges have that opportunity, because they know it through the lawyers, because lawyers are the ones who influence the course of justice. So lawyers have a larger role to play, but for Nani Palkhivala's basic structure doctrine, would we have such a wonderful safeguard to protect the constitution against the vagrancies of ideology? So we have a larger role to play as reformers. I mean, I don't think only law commission member is a reformer. Everybody is a reformer in law, whether it is in the process of letter of the law or in the process of implementation of the law. See, so many law books are there. I don't mean to say proliferating laws are no certainty that there is justice. But at the same time, those laws are at least indicators that society had such a problem. But the laws become live only when we reach them to the people. So we make people to be receptive to the law by telling that it is not something out there in that dungeon of a court or some privileged space with the black coat adorned people. It's yours. You belong to that law, is there to serve you. You are the master of that law. So as long as we don't have faith in these citizens' power, which the constitution says that constitution makes ultimately people the powerful, but we somewhere feel that we are more powerful than those real beneficiaries of law, as the mediators of law. So I suggest in this context that my law commission experience taught me that in these commissions and in these august bodies, we need to have more and more sociological research and sociological data to come in. Of course, they do that. They do that questionnaire and all of that. For them, the duty is done once they put it online and the responses come. So they said 1,300 responses say that 498A is bad. I said, how many responses are from rural side? How many are women? Now, most of the people are either police officers or they are lawyers who have fought the cases of men, or men themselves who are from the IT background, because IT background people seem to be having divorces like that, and there seem to be a lot of violent episodes, like Bangalore accounted for highest domestic violence at that period, so which is the IT hub, and in the age group of those IT engineers, and invariably mostly IT engineers. So there is a, because it is stress and other things, you know, which affects one's way of relating to the other person as well, aside from many other factors. So if you are not qualitatively, critically reviewing what is coming to your table, you may end up making the mistake that 498A is to be abolished. So I had to argue tooth and nail saying, what about those who never used it, disuse? Large percentage of women do not know there is a law, and those who know also are not able to use because they feel it will hamper their relationship to the in-laws, or they may be having little kids for whom they may not be able to provide the money or bread. So that reality has to be captured. So don't remove the law. A law is an indication that there is an ongoing problem. It may not be the initiator. In some cases it is initiator, in some cases it is indicator. Therefore, law being anchored in the society is something that all our august bodies have to do. So I'll give you another example. See, farmers' protest happened and we all know how bad it was. And when the farmer bill was adopted, the protest ensued. After that, in its wisdom, our government has come to many people and we have taken opinions from people and we have sent it to the government, which is a very good step. My only concern is, while advising the government to do this bill, why didn't that forethought come beforehand? It would have saved so much of national loss, so much of bad will for the government and others. I don't blame any particular government, independent of which government, which party. It is, I think, the very principle of governance, which doesn't seem to be looking at community-based law reform. I mean, if this law reform were to be tested in the touchstone of community, I'm sure those insights would have come. They didn't have to circulate it again. So when they circulated to us, we didn't go as a law school in an academic way. We called students and we said, go talk to the farmers. Farmers in Haryana, farmers in Himachal, farmers in Punjab, farmers in Karnataka, movement whom I know very well in Karnataka. So from everybody we collected the data and we sent. So this is the job that every law reformer or every law person ought to do. I don't think anybody is less of a participant or reformer in law just because they are not in the law commission or in the parliament or in any of the committees. Each one of us has a say. Each one of us has a power, and today with the technology, we have lot of ways. Our own Prime Minister, whenever he does Mann Ki Baat, he always solicits views, ministry solicits, which is a good thing about this government. Now, which is a good thing about our techno era, technocratic era. So let's make use of this and let every one of us participate in the law. Today, law has become a kind of institution where apathy, public apathy, I'm not saying they are against law. One is because of delay, thinking that they have concluded that it doesn't work in law. So they go to less of a law kind of private justice, which again lands them in more exploitation and more problems. So time has come for us to accept that our institution is not liked. There is a lot of apathy. We have to make it more participatory, more accepted, more involved. For example, when I was doing this report and data validation and final recommendations synthesis with the Karnataka legislator Dr. Jayamala on reform about sex workers and female sex workers in Karnataka. When I was validating the data, we again spoke to a small group of these women, and we came to know that they had so much of fear about the police, they had so much of hatred about their own existence, and they wanted their own space, dignity. So we made these recommendations, and while making the recommendation, we said the task force which is going to implement it will have 50% of these women. So they will become their own spokesperson. They will identify beneficiaries in their community because nobody can know it as authentically as they do. So I think a time has come for citizens committees. There are some citizens committees everywhere nowadays being introduced, and under RTI also, I mean, especially with the Lokpal and all coming in, we needed that. I think it is still far from the way in which it was expected. It is still a work in progress. We'll hope that it will happen in this tenure of the government. So these are the kinds of things which show us very clearly that we need to bring law more closer to people, and then only the law can become well enforced and more, it will reach its goal of justice.
I think that's a very valid point and wonderful report, because as you said, law should not be looked at a UFO type of object by the common citizenry, and I think that is very important, because there is a disconnect of what the institution, I mean, especially the judiciary, has been formulated as a pillar of the democracy, and people feel a disconnect with it. Because a lot of time I see on social media, especially nowadays, and even in general public, there is a lot of remorse against how the system is working. And I think every one of us as together, we need to be a stakeholder. And I think that is one of the mandate for which we have started this channel, so that we can brainstorm ideas and later hopefully implement it with different stakeholders, be it educational institutions, be it the ministry, be it the government, be it lawyers, be it whosoever who wants to be a part of a change for good. And having said that, ma'am, I must thank you for giving so much of your valuable time, especially on a Sunday. But before we conclude, as is the custom of our program, I always ask for a closing comment for our viewers, who I say is youth. But when I say youth, I don't only mean people who are young. You know, I also mean people who are young at heart and young in mind. So your closing comments for them.
Yeah, youth is our promise, and youth is our tomorrow, and youth is our hope. And I'm so happy and proud to share with you that I would hate my life if I didn't have the opportunity to be touching young lives and being touched by them and shaping their lives. Although I also consider myself as eternally youthful internally, the body gives way. But youth is something that is a power of, I mean, that has the force of rejuvenation, the adventure, dreams, hopes, novelty. Don't give up. I mean, one COVID is not going to rob us of our meaningfulness of life. You are still young. You will live with this memory. This may traumatize you in many ways, but I think all traumas are to be taken as a kind of expanding experience, because as I told you, my own life journey also, those traumas have left sometimes uncontrollable deep impacts, but it has always been a propelling force to discover the sweetness of life. So you are full of that melody and mellifluous side of life. Enjoy it and never give it up. And I tell you that justice is the core of youth, about that adventure, about that love. And as I already told, it is love in action. So participate in justice as a lawyer, if not as a law student or lawyer, if it is not your cup of tea, live the life of justice as you grow up. And never give up on the face of injustice. Because that is the power we have as people to transform. All the best.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. And before we conclude, it's a wonderful takeaway that be somebody's melody and not a malady. I think that is my takeaway from your closing comment. And thank you so much for discussing your personal journey, your professional journey, and how you have transformed lives. And also evolved wonderful jurisprudence across your professional journey of over 3 decades. I'm grateful to have you here, and with this, I must also appeal to my viewers that you know that we have started this channel, and the mandate is to increase positivity, to increase legal awareness, which reaches the masses. And for us to be able to do that, I always pray and plea to the audience that the simplest way to do that is like, share, and subscribe to our channel. See you soon. And with that, I pray to God for good health and prosperity to you, ma'am. And on that note, see you soon.
And Jayant, all the best to your channel. This is a great initiative. I'm sure that this is going to grow as the great voice of justice.
Thank you. Thank you so much.